Yeah. What a good-looking crowd. Thank you, Ava, for that introduction, and thanks to all of you guys. I don't think there's ever been an assemblage like this on one stage. I was thinking when I was standing there, gee, I hope the boiler doesn't blow or something. We could cripple all of urban America right here. So my job tonight is to try and draw these shy, retiring leaders out in a discussion about their cities and cities generally. But I want to talk, I've got a great interest in the office of mayor. I've worked for a lot of mayors and been involved in a lot of campaigns. I think it's a unique office. But Ram, let me start with you. You were a congressman. You were the White House chief of staff. And yet you say this is the best job you've ever had. Why?
Well, you get to do panels like this, Dave. on a serious note, because you can actually not only come up with the policy, but you can move the needle and see the impact on people's lives. First of all, right now, not that it's been different, but it's kind of worse than ever. Washington's a bit of, you know, Disneyland on the Potomac, and it performs to that level. At our local level, this is the government that's closest to people and how they live their lives. Mm-hmm. Where you do a park, where you do a library, what you do, and you can move in a policy that impacts people's lives. Whether it's a full school day, full school year, we're redoing every playground in the city of Chicago, top to bottom. Mm-hmm. And that turns people out in a way, in at least those two things, in a positive sense of what they care. And I think you can not only develop the policy, you can see it through, and you can move the needle, and you can impact people's lives in a way that's actually relevant to how they feel they live their lives. And that's, and I'll give you, we used to be, as you know, David, because you lived here, we were a tale of two cities on recycling. Half our city had it, half did not. We made changes, and you go to parts of the city, now they thank you for recycling. And that is how they feel they live their lives, and that was a service we were delivering to some but not others, and now we can do it. You couldn't do that as, and I love being chief of staff. You know I love working for both presidents. I was honored to be congressman. But you can really move the needle and or put your thumb on the scale and tip it, and that in a dramatic way.
Eric, you were telling me a story when we were talking about this a minute ago. Talk a little bit about your experience. You were a member of the city council, and Bill, you were as well. What has surprised you about this job? Is it a better job than you thought? What is it about the mayor's office that you said every day is a good day for you?
It is, and let me say how wonderful it is to be here in Chicago. I'm not sure what all that white stuff outside is, and I actually put my hands in it and it hurts, but other than that, it looks really beautiful.
It's water.
Oh, it's water. Thank you. That clears it all up. And we need some of that stuff, too. But we...
we'll sell it to you.
I guess I was going to say this later, but I'm so pleased to be here. I was looking at weather.com. It's 38, and I think it's a little rainy in Atlanta today. It's 27 in New York and 27 here in Chicago. It's 70 degrees and still sunny out in Los Angeles. So I invite you all to come to a beautiful city and see not only what real weather is about, but also to understand.
We can take showers year round.
Yes, that's right. That's kind of strange because it doesn't smell like that up here. But anyway. But we have a lot of fun, I think, as mayors. We connect instantly with each other because at the end of the day, it is accountable. It is immediate. It is tangible. It is something material. And I love this job. I mean, Ram and I were just meeting earlier today, and there's really no downside to it. There's challenging days. There's immense things you have to overcome. Some of the toughest challenges in America really exist in cities. But the ability to live in a place and to have that level of accountability, if you don't fix it, you still live in that city, so you have to drive over that pothole. You have to see the lack of green space. You have to personally deal with those issues. But if you do change something, you get to experience that too as somebody who lives in the city, who's not commuting off to a state capital or to Washington, D.C. And the story that I was sharing a little earlier was I was with President Obama in the White House after I was elected, and he said, you know, how's the job? And I said, it's great. And I quoted to him President Clinton's old aphorism that the two best jobs in politics are President of the United States or mayor of a big city. And it was the week that the healthcare website was rolling out, a couple other things. He said, you can scratch the first one from that list. So I truly believe we have the best job in politics. The toughest one, perhaps, but absolutely the best to see things like number of parks triple in the area where you are, to be able to see things move, to balance our budgets, the pension challenges that we've all not only attacked but been able to go after in a way that we know 20 years from now, when nobody knows our names anymore, will make a huge difference. Looking at the way that really important issues like what Bill's doing in New York. I mean, this is of national importance to talk about universal pre-care for folks, and the courage that mayors can have to put those things on the agenda when Washington is broken. I'll end with this. When I went with the 16 mayors that were elected last year with Bill to the White House, and we had a meeting. These are mayors of great cities, Seattle, Pittsburgh, New York, LA, et cetera. And I said, if this was the 60s or the 70s and America's cities were burning, we would have been coming to Washington to ask you as the president to save America's cities, to have Washington save America's cities. But we're here now doing the opposite. America's cities are here to save Washington. And I truly believe that's what's happening.
Who wants to sign on to the proposition that nobody will remember you in 20 years? Mm-hmm. You guys all up for that? So, Kasim, you were a state legislator.
Yes.
For years before you became mayor. What was the perspective of a legislator becoming mayor and the difference between those levels of government?
It made me a better executive because I treat legislators well. And at the end of the day, if you want to take decisive action, you've got to get your votes. And so I served 4 years in the House in Georgia and 7 years in the Senate. And I remember the first time when I first got elected, I got up to speak. And the Speaker of the House, Tom Murphy, the longest serving speaker in the country, took the cigar out of his mouth. He said, come here. And I walked up, David, I had raised my hand. He said, son, it should be about a year before you talk. And I thought that I had been elected. And then he took my parking space and he moved it so far away.
It would be a year before you spoke.
Yeah. Yeah, because of that walk.
That's right.
But it was great preparation, David, because it made me learn the rules. It made me train and be prepared and spend 4 to 7 years getting to know the state. And so now the city of Atlanta and the state of Georgia, which is very conservative, enjoys a working relationship that's rare in the United States of America. And I believe that it was because of those 11 years that I spent learning and gaining a respect for the state and for people all across the state, but also understanding how important the capital city of the state is.
And plus, that the now end you can of talk day, whatever you want.
Yeah, I know. And then now, when I've got an idea, I get to execute. So I think that after being a legislator for 11 years, all of the things that you dreamed about, you get to go do. And when we're in the House or the Senate, we can keep running forever. But my job, I'm term limited. I got 8 years. And I say all of the time that cities are where hope meets the street. And when you get in those jobs, and you know you've got an 8-year time limit on you, it focuses you and causes you to make decisions in a decisive way and to take risk that you otherwise might not take. It changes you.
What about you, Bill? You like Eric's, were toiled in the city council for years. How's life changed for you? I know there's a lot of reporters here. I think that's one way in which life has changed
there's
for you.
A lot of reporters around. Yeah. I've noticed that. First of all, I just want to say it's a joy to be with my colleagues. I'm the rookie of this group. It's just been about 2 months for me, but these are all friends. And we spent a lot of time over the months talking to each other, supporting each other, and that alone makes it a great experience. But I just want to say something about this man, because I have to embarrass him for a moment. I've known David for 14 years now. And you haven't heard it enough because you're too modest. You've done a hell of a lot for Chicago. You've done a hell of a lot for the United States of America.
Thank
so
you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I had two tough questions that I'm now going to eliminate.
Yeah, take those off. Take those off. That's the first lesson of politics. Be nice to the host. So I think the reality, I want to pick up on what my colleague said. There is something electric about this type of work. And I've been a legislator. You know, we've all been legislators in different ways, locally, state, national. When you can have a vision, put it before the people, get it ratified by the people, and then, like a bat out of hell, go and act on it. And you know, Kasim is aggressive, Eric's aggressive, Rahm's kind of laid back, but I'm aggressive.
We're all rated on a curve.
Everyone's got their own style, Rahm. It's okay.
That's right.
It's okay. Don't ever change. But the fact is, I actually take inspiration from ROM's energy in the way you approach it. You put forward your agenda, and then that clock is running. Kasim said, you have two terms. I look at that as a running clock in a healthy way, in a driving way, in an inspirational way to say, we've got to get a lot done. And I think if you look at the successful mayors, including the folks on this stage to my left, the success is in large measure by defining an agenda and relentlessly pursuing it. I appreciate what Eric said about full day pre-K, and we've said we're gonna get full day pre-K for every child in New York City, period. It's the goal, we have to do it. And it's gonna fundamentally change New York City and the future of New York City if every child is guaranteed full day pre-K. And then it's about marshaling the resources and building the support and having the fights and whatever it takes, but we get to do that in a way we never could as legislators. I'm not, if anyone in the audience is planning on being a legislator, please do, it's a good thing too. I had a great experience. But there is something energizing, captivating about being a mayor and just the amount you get done in a single day. Sometimes, I'm sure you've all had experience, at the end of a day you look back and what you got done in a day that would have taken months in another setting, and that alone makes it inspirational.
So Eric, I'm gonna give you less time than the others, and I want you guys to give me the brief, and I'll tell you why, the briefest answer, your elevator pitch for your cities. We have major cities from every region in this country. Well, you already started giving your elevator pitch. We're already on the basement. We've gone from the 70th floor to the basement. We've heard about the temperature. Yeah. We've heard about, but so.
The showers.
Yeah, well, we have, okay. Well, you'll get rebuttal time. No, but Kasim, let's start with you. When you talk up Atlanta and you're trying to bring businesses there, when you're trying to bring families there, when you're trying to bring all kinds of other economic activity there, what is it that you say about the city of Atlanta, the Atlanta metropolitan area? And I guess your microphone is.
Thank you. I'd say that we are a city that you can bring your dreams to. And we are driven by talent and merit. And that if you're somebody that values having a fair shot and a fair shake and wants to be at the heart of the city based upon your talent and merit, we're the place for you. And we're also a city for which inclusion is a part of our DNA. And we're the home of Dr. Martin Luther King, who played a fundamental role in expanding freedom and making sure that folks have rights across the United States and changing the tapestry of the country. And so what I tell folks is, we're open for you. And so if you want to bring your dreams to Atlanta, you're not going to have to wait in line. You're going to have a shot to be at the center of action based upon your talent and your merit, your hard work and your energy and your passion. And we're a city that's been built verifiably by dreamers and others who brought their dreams there.
So Bill, whatever happened to, if you can make it there, you can make it anywhere. You gotta wait in line in New York?
That's kind of catchy.
Yes.
Good.
Make your pitch for...
Look, I say with love for all my colleagues and the great cities of this country. I mean, we in New York, I can safely say we have it all. It is a city for everyone. It's a city for every kind of person. I mean that with absolute appreciation for others, but we take pride in the breadth of what we have. Every kind of community, every kind of nationality and ethnicity, a tremendous creative energy, entrepreneurial energy, obviously one of the global capitals of business, communications, now more and more technology. There's so much happening that people can key into. And I agree with Kasim, you can bring your dreams to New York, and you have an immense opportunity to do something with it. And of course, we're the ultimate city of immigrants, and so when I say you can bring your dreams to New York, that means from literally anywhere, and that's the norm in New York. I do think at the same time that we have some things we have to fix in our city. One of the things I said in my campaign is that we're living a tale of two cities in terms of opportunity, and there's some things we have to do to improve the opportunity levels for everyone. Things like pre-K, things like raising up wages and benefits, and we're relentlessly going about that, and it's gonna make a difference, I'm convinced. But the core of what New York is about historically is this extraordinary inclusive opportunity and this extraordinary creative energy, and that is stronger than ever.
So, Ram, you wanna take a swing for the home team?
Yeah, I mean, well, your question is directed at you're recruiting a company.
Or not just a company, a company, a family. Well, what is it that makes Chicago unique and appealing?
Well, first of all, Chicago is the most American of American cities. It's the most American of American cities because we're a city of immigrants We're not just known as the city of big shoulders, but it's built on the shoulders of immigrants, just like my grandfather came here in 1917 as a 13-year-old by himself, not knowing a word of English. And in a generation, his grandson is mayor, not only in America, but in the city of Chicago. Number two, as I say to businesses on a regular basis, we have now been rated by both IBM and The Economist magazine as the second most competitive economy in all of North America. 35% of the people in the city of Chicago have a four-year college degree or better, and we have the institutions like the University of Chicago and all the others that continue to put highly educated workers into the economy, growing it. And we have more people from the Big Ten state universities than any other city in America, alumni. So the workforce is educated and the institutions to back it up. We have the most connected airport rated, the most connected airport in all of North America, the only one that allows you to get to anywhere in a country or anywhere in the world directly daily, weather permitting, and we're working on that. Third, we have the cultural institutions. We have the number one museum, the most amount of Tony Award-winning theater companies tied with New York, the institution of cultural life. So we have a world-class workforce, a world-class transportation system, and a world-class city to give you and the companies here. Now, just yesterday, Site Magazine cited Chicago as the number one city last year for new corporate headquarters and recruitment and expansions. Because of all the strengths that are built in the city institutionally, we will be as strong, as I said, our downtown district, 2 mile radius around downtown, is the fastest growing central business district in America by a factor of three.
I know she didn't, now, mention, I know she didn't mention the baseball teams.
Okay.
That's a very sensitive topic, David. That's not appropriate.
And the good news is that's good. The standard of the city will be that when you get out that 2 mile radius and a child walking out of a school, a child walking out of a place of worship, a child walking out of their home, regardless of where they are, north, west, or south of that downtown, and they can see the energy, they can see the excitement, they can see the promise. Do they think their future is part of that, or do they think their future is only contained to what's in front of them? And we will only be the city we can be if every child, regardless of their perspective of the city, thinks they have a future in this city. And that's how we measure success.
Eric, if you want to add something to what you said before, go ahead. But I do want to get to the challenges. I figured I'd give each of you guys a chance to do a commercial, and then I'd...
And that was very beautifully said, Ram. And these are three great cities. If you want to move there, if you want to put your business there, if you want to stay here, please do. But if you want to know why Los Angeles, besides the weather, is such an incredible place, I think Los Angeles has been both a symbol for America as well as the incarnation of kind of the highest ideals of this country. We're creators and we're innovators. We're the western capital of the United States, the northern capital of Latin America, the eastern capital of the Pacific Rim. If we didn't have a city there right now, we'd have to build one simply because of the intersection of these amazing global forces. We've got the highest rate of entrepreneurialism of any city in America. More than one out of 200 Angelenos is an entrepreneur. We've got the industries that you all know about, of course, Hollywood, aerospace. We put, you know, rovers on Mars. During the Olympics, 90 medals during the London Olympics were won by Angelenos, which is two more than China. We would have been second in the world if we were a nation. But we have three top 25 universities, the only city in the country to have three top 25 universities, three top 100 global universities. But I think Los Angeles's challenge is we have such an embarrassment of riches, the weather, the people, the most... No, seriously, hear me out here.
I thought this was going to be short.
Hear me out. Because this is the criticism and this is the challenge piece. We've been almost lazy about putting the pieces together. And I will compliment these gentlemen because I think there's been a stronger civic fabric in other cities. Los Angeles has been a very libertarian place. We always had the weather, we always had the land. We didn't need to do some of the things that cities needed to. And so my challenge as mayor is how do we begin to stitch these pieces together of this immense diversity, 220 languages, 150 countries of origin, 37 countries have their largest population outside their home country in LA. That's never happened before on the face of the earth. But we have to figure out a way to build, I think, and learn from some of our other and older cities how we get that civic fabric to be able to fulfill the dream Ram talked about for that kid.
Okay, we'll vote on your favorite city at the end of the program.
I think it's a little bit rigged. You know?
That's the way we like our
You're
election.
In Chicago, bro. That's how we do it here.
Typical Chicago election. And by the way, vote as many times as you want. Just keep coming and coming.
But you don't even need to be alive.
But you get just ask how many ballots you want beforehand. We'll give them to you.
Bill began to touch on this. Bill began to touch on this. For all the great advantages that each of your cities offer, you're all faced with challenges and problems. And I'd like you each to talk about what you think the greatest challenge facing your city is. Kasim, you want to?
I think we have
two challenges. We have the challenges that many people who live in the city have to pay what I call a private school tax. We're in the middle of transforming our public education system and coming out of one of the worst cheating scandals in America and picking a new leader and working through all of the pain that went with that process in order to make sure that our children have no ceiling on their lives. So that's hard. And then we're also—
You don't have the authority to, you don't—
No, I don't have control. Elected school board, I don't have the control of the school board, but I've got a pretty big voice in how that happens. And, you know, when we had our cheating scandal, I called up the Chancellor of Higher Education for the state of Georgia. He was retiring on a Friday. He was the head of APS on a Monday, our public school system. And his wife hasn't spoken to me since. And so I certainly played a role in stabilizing the system. And then I think the second challenge we have is in the area of infrastructure. The city of Atlanta and the Atlanta Metro got to where it is about 15 years too fast, David. We're now the ninth largest metro in the US, 5.9 million people, in the 10th biggest state. And the infrastructure was not built for that. And so at a time when the federal government is reducing what it's prepared to put in, we grew very fast. We were among the four fastest growing metros over the last 2 years. So all of these are problems that are tied to our success, but they're here on our watch, and I've got to figure out how to deal with them at a time when we have less federal support and in a very conservative state overall.
Let's go down the row, and then let's pick up some of these problems. I suspect there's some commonalities between your concerns. So, Bill, you want to?
Sure. I've said throughout my campaign last year, the greatest challenge facing New York City is an inequality crisis. And bluntly, I think the inequality crisis in this country is a challenge for all of us. In New York City, we have the greatest income inequality since the Great Depression, since 1929. And getting worse all the time. We have 46% of our people at or near the poverty level. That number would have been inconceivable a decade or two ago. So this is the reality we face in this country. It's been intensified, or the effect has been intensified in our city because of the high cost of living, but let's face it, wages and benefits have been pushed downward over the course of decades. And a lot of what we fundamentally believe in as Americans and the kind of opportunity we think is essential to the nature of this country is being undermined. So I do believe, and I think it picks up on Eric's point about a tradition in each city about what the role of government is and what the civic conversation is. From my point of view, the conversation we had last year in New York City was about inequality and the fact that the government would have to play an active role in addressing it. We are taking steps right now to push wages and benefits up. We just passed, I'm very proud of the fact that working with our city council, we passed a law to provide paid sick leave, paid sick days, to 500,000 more people than have it now in New York City. That's a tangible benefit that's gonna help people keep money in their pocket and not have the dislocation in their life when they're sick. We're gonna do a lot to bring wage levels up, including with all the companies that the city subsidizes and does business with. We wanna take the living wage concept and use that to the maximum extent possible to take that public involvement with the private sector and use it to leverage better wage levels. Obviously believe there needs to be an increase in the minimum wage. And we think in New York, we think a city like New York should set its own minimum wage because our cost of living is higher. So there's a lot we have to do on that front. Of course, I think for the long run to address inequality, it runs through education. That's why our very aggressive plan is full day pre-K for every child in the city, after school programs for every middle school student, literally every middle school student that needs them. So we extend the school day. We build opportunity for the long run. But we have to fire on all those cylinders if we're going to address what is now an inequality crisis. And it picks up on the point about the dynamics of DC that we're all feeling. We know there is not a cavalry coming right now from Washington. And I think the analogy of what we would have felt if we were sitting on the stage in 1968 or 1978, we would have had a different set of assumptions about partnership. Now it's what can we generate ourselves? We have to build up our economies. You heard everyone's pitch. We have to build up our economies, and then we have to use the tools of government to create more opportunity and to address inequality head on. That's the big challenge.
The you raised the exact right point, which is in the 1960s, there was a steady flow of funds from Washington for the cities. There is no flow now. how much has that made the relationship with state governments more important? You hinted at this before, Kasim, and your relationship with the state government. How much do you rely on the state government, if not for funding, then for the flexibility to do the things that you want to do?
I think flexibility is the key word. It's not cash, it's not resources. But more important than the relationship with the state government, the federal government needs to change its relationship with cities.
Amen.
The federal government is functioning under an outdated model that shifts money to 50 states,
yep,
as opposed to shifting resources to the GDP. So 70% of the country's GDP is in cities that we lead, but despite that fact, we still have to deal with states. So if the federal government wanted to boost productivity in American cities, they would change the old formula and stop forcing us to work through states regarding our resources and send the money directly to us, because we get it to where it is needed faster and more efficiently, and we're more accountable to citizens.
Yeah. Ram, you want to pick up on your...
Look, the problem, we're at a unique moment in American history. Cities are in their renaissance. And at this moment in time, and we talk about 68, I mean, I always, when I first got elected, I said I would love to have been mayor in the late 90s, where cash was everywhere, man.
I wasn't born. So.
Yeah. The late 90s?
68.
Oh, yeah.
68.
Oh. Well, you missed a lot.
Yeah, I know.
Okay. So my point, we're in a renaissance, and this gets up, but Washington's AWOL. Totally AWOL. The state capitals have their own, at least we know here in Illinois, they have huge budgetary problems. And so we are cast on our own in a moment in time where you have to kind of boost the economy, et cetera. I would say to the three challenges, David, that you asked about. One is first and foremost, which is why, right, is education. You can't have a city, in my view, where you had a graduation rate when I was running, it was in the mid-50s. Now the good news is we're now on track to get to 80% in 4 years. And that means every child, and it's, you know, and those are tough decisions, but, you know, we have now, we used to have the shortest school day in America of any big city. We now have a full school day. We have universal kindergarten for the first time for every child in the city of Chicago, a full school day of kindergarten. And that's the predicate that Bill was talking about, because if you're going to make sure there's great high schools in your city, and we've reinvigorated with IB, International Baccalaureate, STEM, military, other choices for them, you're going to have high schools, but you're going to make sure that we have kids for those high schools can really accomplish. And it does start earlier. I would say in the challenge part, and this gets me, and the promise, there's nothing more kind of symbolic. Last Tuesday, the city of Chicago was awarded this grant for advanced manufacturing, $320 million grant. It's the cutting edge of both what I call brains and brawns coming together on the most important digital manufacturing for the country, and it will be the center both in the United States on digital manufacturing and all the research dollars that are coming in from the private sector, the universities, and the federal government. 1 week later, Moody's downgrades us because of the pension. 1 week, Tuesday to Tuesday. All the promise of this incredible opportunity, and I brought to the White House two kids from our STEM high school that were on the cover of Time magazine, Sarah Good on the south side, Michelle Clark on the west side, because that research grant, that opportunity, if they get trained, that's their future. The new companies, the patents, the license coming out. But if we don't deal respectfully in the right way on the pension, and Bill and I are now in the midst of that struggle, well, these two guys have a different set because of the hard work, people were yelling, that decision by Moody's can rob that future. You got it. And I said, like, we're gonna get close to a time where you're gonna pick between a pension payment, a pothole, and paving a road. And that's the wrong choices for a world-class city. And so that's both the promise and also the challenge that I think exists. And our states they got their challenges, and the federal government basically, and everybody talked about this day, there will be a day when the federal government is interest on the debt, national security, and entitlement, Social Security, Medicare. Well, folks, that day's here. They don't do after school. I'll give you one clear example. We did a 150% increase in summer jobs. 20,000 summer kids went to summer jobs last year, largest since the war on poverty. We were talking about this today. The federal government's participation, they had a 90% cut. It was 700 kids. out of 20,000. I said, don't apply for it. It costs you more money to apply for it when you get the kid. We'll figure out the 700 on our own. They've left the kids because they're going to pay Social Security, Medicare, National Security, and they're going to pay interest on the debt at a time in which your metropolitan centers are your economic engines and capacities. And so that's both the promise as well as the challenge of where we are.
Eric, you hear echoes of your own challenges in this discussion, or yours?
Absolutely. I've enjoyed listening to the three peers here that I have, my three friends, and it reminds me of when Winston Churchill once said, everything that needs to be said has been said, but it hasn't been said by everybody. So thank you for asking. I agree completely, and I think there's something happening in this country. And in all seriousness, it's something that all of us really have to focus on as Americans. America will not come back and recover if America's cities do not. And in our state capitals and in our nation's capital, people have forgotten about cities. I don't want to say they've given up on them, because they've never been more exciting. They've never been a more interesting platform for innovation, for creativity, even city government, which, you know, when I look at Los Angeles and I said we had cutting-edge technology when I came in, but it was from 1982. Hmm. You know, we have this moment where I came this morning from Mexico. The jefe de gobierno, which is what they call the mayor there, he and I got together, we're sister cities, as I believe Chicago is Mexico City. The first 2 minutes, we're pulling out each other's smartphones and sharing apps. He's got an app on air quality. I've got an app on real-time parking spaces in Hollywood. He has an app on where the protests are in Mexico City, because you need a whole app for that. And I have an app that, you know, like many folks do here, where you can repair a pothole in, you know, 24 hours by taking a picture and not waiting on hold. We have these exciting platforms. We have these renaissances that are going on. But what these three gentlemen were talking about is the same in Los Angeles with me. It is infrastructure and it's inequality or opportunity. Los Angeles is creating high-paying jobs at a faster rate than low-paying jobs. And yet our poverty rate is higher 5 years after the recession started than before. When I tried to square those statistics together and understand why, it meant that people who aren't growing up in my city are getting those jobs. So we're still magnets internationally, nationally, for people to come into the cities to get these great jobs as animators, as aerospace engineers. SpaceX, which is, you know, based in Los Angeles, is launching satellites into space. We have this amazing American innovation happening, but with no help from the nation. When we look at infrastructure, we have the biggest public transit infrastructure construction project going on in Los Angeles. Kind of the capital of cars is finally going to transit. But we had to pass a tax on ourselves, and we just come to Washington not with an empty hat in hand, but an almost full hat, begging for them just to top it off, and even that's tough. And when you face these cuts in the midst of the worst recession of our lives, to see block grants, to see home dollars for affordable housing, to see these things get cut, it's unconscionable. This is our tax dollars. For Republicans who say they want to give local control, give it. For Democrats who say they care about poverty, fight the fight. But you cannot give up on America's cities precisely at a moment when we represent people who are innovating, creating, and moving the American dream forward.
Amen. And I think you hear in all of us a commonality that a self-sufficiency, sort of strategic dynamic that we have to make things happen, that we generate in our within our borders, because we understand the pressures that states are under, and we understand what we're not going to have from Washington. And everyone on this stage sees that as a challenge that we have to live up to, and we make things happen every day. But that doesn't mean this is a status quo that's acceptable for the long haul, because the future of this country lives and dies by the cities. We're the economic engines. And I think if you look around the world, I always like to say, look at your economic competitors. Look at how they think about infrastructure investment, how they think about research, how they think about investment in education. China, India, Germany, go down a list. All think of their government as the ultimate facilitators and sort of the pavers of the pathway so all these other things can happen, including in the private sector, to lift everyone up. Here, we're stuck. Then, once again, where do we have to turn for a change dynamic? It has to start with all of us. And my theory has been that in sort of the Tea Party era, we can throw up our hands or we can say, wait a minute, the Tea Party was an organic movement that somehow ended up with outsized influence in the Congress and now is making everything else impossible, even though we command huge populations that require that kind of support from Washington, that kind of investment for the good of all. Those Tea Party congressmen come from states that also have big cities in them, and medium-sized cities and small cities, all of which need that federal help for infrastructure, et cetera, mass transit, et cetera. So we have to change the politics. We can't throw up our hands. We can't curse the darkness. We have to change the politics in Washington. I believe there's a way all of us working together can start to change that. We've seen some great things. My predecessor, I had some disagreements with him. There's some other things I thought very highly of, including some of his national efforts, for example, on gun control. But I think we all have to have a national effort on infrastructure. We have to have a national effort on Washington investment in the future of our country through our cities.
Let me just return for a second to the education issue, because you all agree that this is fundamental. Every single city is the tale of two cities to some degree. New York may be accentuated because of the fantastic wealth of the financial industry.
And the cost of living.
But every one of you is dealing with this, and everyone agrees that education is the key. What are the barriers here? You talk about, what is it, NEET? Is that the... no employment, education, and training? Is that the acronym that you use?
I mean, the barriers are will. We need to have the constraints removed from mayors and local governments to move as fast and to take an approach like Roosevelt. And you know it, David, from when you were leading in the
White
House.
I wasn't alive when Roosevelt was alive.
No, I wasn't. Exactly.
I know you weren't born in 1968, campaign. But please.
No, it's okay. I wasn't.
David introduced him to polling.
Yeah. I was just focusing on the need for us to be much more urgent about the approaches to solving our educational challenges.
But what would that mean, Kasim? That's what I'm asking.
I'll tell you exactly what it means. It means going through the educational initiatives in your city, finding what works best, and using your political will to implement it faster.
That's right.
And what happens right now is, even when you have genuine success, you have to take too long to implement it. And we're not trying with the amount of urgency and importance that's related to the future of kids right now. So we have approaches that are not being tried in our public school systems because of the risk associated with the approaches. And the educational future...
The risk meaning what?
The political risk, David. So I had a question in one of the classes that I walked over here, and folks asked me about charter initiatives and school reform initiatives because I'm a Democrat. And what I said is, I will flat out support what works and what is verifiable, and I will put my political will behind it and take political risk based upon merit and success. And more mayors have to do that because we have the ability to move faster than they do at the federal level.
Bill, so you're in the middle of a discussion in New York on this issue of charter schools. Mm-hmm. I mean, would you associate yourself with what Kasim just said? And if so, how does that square with your view on the charters in New York?
I think charters are part of the lineup. I think they're part of an approach that we have to take that has to be transformative. I think the challenge, and we're seeing it right now in New York, the discussion often goes towards, you know, the education culture wars, as opposed to where are the vast majority of kids and what do we do to help them. So we're having some disagreements right now in the city on charters, but my central message is we're going to work with charter schools. We're going to hold them to equivalent standards that we hold the traditional public schools to. We're not going to create a favoritism for one group or another. We're going to work with all across the board. And we want all schools to be inclusive of English language learners, to be inclusive of special ed kids. We want a common standard. But that discussion pales in comparison to the question, for example, on early childhood education. And until recently, it was very hard to get a discussion going, a civic discussion going on early childhood education. There's no question qualitatively and impact-wise, getting early childhood education right, really making the focus on it, putting our money where our mouth is there, has a much greater multiplier effect than any other thing we can do in education. Extending the school day, and there's lots of ways to do it. We're doing it by the after-school route. But we know these are big structural things that in our city reaches ultimately hundreds of thousands of kids. We have a school system of 1.1 million kids. Whereas charters in our city at this point are about 5 or 6% of our kids. So about, I think it's about 70,000 kids right now. So all I would say is that what a lot of us, I think, are affected by is a series of realities that don't actually, of political realities, of public debate realities, that don't conform to what is actually the most strategically necessary thing for the future of our cities. One thing I think you can find out about all of us, we are thinking about today, we're thinking about next year, we're thinking about 5 years ahead, 10 years ahead, 20 years ahead. Mm-hmm. For my city, I need full-day pre-K if I'm going to build the school system of tomorrow. I need after-school if I'm going to build it. I need teacher retention. You will not find a front-page story on the crisis of teacher retention in our city. I bet it's true in other cities, too. You'll find 100 stories on charter schools, but you won't find a story about the fact that we have a great generation of teachers. They come into our schools, and then we lose them in 5 years. And that's what's holding back public education.
Let me, 2 points, if I can, David. First of all, tenor-wise here, everybody will give you, like, on this subject, unlike any other, a sense of urgency. Every one of us. So if you pick nothing up, it's a sense on education, on that space itself. I'm talking about urgency in the sense of also what we started, but as a mayor, but the sense of urgency on education, because you see so much promise and so much wasted.
That's right.
Second, I think the entire debate around education has been screwed up by its politics.
Yes.
And here's what I mean. It's not about that reform or this specific, it's about quality. It's about quality education. And every effort, we did universal kindergarten, we're doing more on pre-K, Bill deserves a lot of credit for that introduction, we've added kids. We have a view all the way through from early childhood, including the community colleges, so they're on the playing field helping kids get an education that lead to a career. But it's all about quality. Now when I ran, specifically, you know this, we have a problem in the city, which was the fact that we had 4 of the 5 top grade high schools in the state were here in the city of Chicago. And then everything else, people by 5th grade would flee for the suburbs because they didn't think they had a high school choice for their family. So I've reinvigorated the neighborhood schools with the 5 STEM high schools that go from 9th grade to 14th grade. They were just on the cover of Time magazine, so the Sarah Good. We've expanded now to the largest international baccalaureate program of any high school system in the country here, based on a University of Chicago study of IB versus selective enrollment. We've added SEET to our selective enrollment in our best high schools. We now have more military high schools, where there are 6 applicants for every seat. They have an 80% graduation rate, 90% college attendance. And the real debate isn't about charter versus neighborhood. The debate is quality versus failure. That's where the debate is on education. And as Kasim said, we have to adopt anything that gets you to quality. And it's not about the means, it's about the end. And there's a sense, you cannot, this is where Atlanta, being the home of Dr. King, and on education, the civil rights movement began with education, the fierce urgency of now. Mm-hmm. And we cannot allow the politics to get in the way of having another generation because it was too politically difficult.
Now let me ask a blunt question. When you guys talk about the politics, I feel like we're being euphemistic about this. Is this a labor issue, a union issue? Is that, what exactly are the political barriers to reform?
Well, if you put together, David, the most pro-charter, conservative school reformer, in quotes, with the most active union, hardcore activist, and get them for a moment to say, what does a good school look like? They'll have an identical conversation.
That's right.
So we are losing all of our time saying, are you pro-charter or anti-charter?
Yeah, it's a wrong
are you for
debate.
Teacher unions or against teacher unions? You know, I'm for charter schools, and I was endorsed by the teachers union, and both were confused. They said, oh, we don't know if we can trust him. Well, I got elected mayor, so I guess it's okay.
That's right.
But the point was, I think
it's
there's
all in
three
the temperature.
Things. Exactly.
It goes to your head.
There's three things. Early ed, consensus. Great campuses, a consensus. And let me go a little more in detail. Every campus should have a health clinic in it. If you have an undiagnosed medical condition, mental or physical, you can't learn. Every ball field should be an after-school space, joint use between cities and school districts. Make sure we have more than one counselor for 3,000 kids like we do in my city so we can get kids to college. So build great campuses. And then the third piece is align curriculum with jobs. And it isn't rocket science. You know, in the past you'd go to a shop class because we're going to get a factory job in aerospace and live a middle-class life in Los Angeles. Well, today we're creating a new tech firm, digital tech firm, every 40 hours. After Silicon Beach and Tel Aviv, we're rated number 3 in the world right now. And watch out, Tel Aviv, because we're coming. So we have the ability to hire people right now without a college degree, $70,000 starting salary if you know computer coding. So in South Los Angeles, I'm starting an initiative called Silicon South, which will allow us to take, and we've already started 2 schools, Dorsey High School and Crenshaw High School, among our poorest and lowest performing high schools, where we have computer science teachers in there. This past summer, 10 kids created 34 smartphone apps. The White House honored them. They are going to be the founders of great companies, as well as getting great jobs. We've been so scared of vocational education as a term for so long, of tracking kids, that we've forgotten this is actually where the middle class prosperity is. Whether it's in aerospace, whether it's in digital technology, or whether it's in the healthcare industry, we've got to align our education system with that, using the community college districts. And one last thing, I'm really proud of what Rahm's done here, and we're looking to emulate it in Los Angeles, is take the summer and make sure kids get ahead during the summer. Do a summer of learning program, do a summer jobs program for youth. It's something that I put most
don't
of my political cap.
Don't jump in the lake if they read 2 million books. That's my road. If you're going to come up with a number,
no,
challenge the kids on
Los
a big
Angeles,
number.
Jumping in the ocean is so nice, I'll happily do that
I can't believe you walked into that.
I do want to say, he heard about our summer learning. Yep. What we did with our libraries, with Rahm's Readers, and what they did, our Park District summer camp. He immediately sent people, and this is one thing, we all learn from each other.
That's right.
And he's got a variation that now I want to look at what we're doing. And so my point is, we did this summer learning because there's a summer slide.
Yep.
You can't get a year-round education. Kids need a year-round education. So we instituted this summer learning and challenged kids on books and reading and learning and have a digital badge that they get. MacArthur paid for it, Foundation. And my ultimate goal, and we were talking about this today, is in 4 years, when a child shows up to school, they're going to show up with their medical records and they're going to show up with their electronic badges and tell you what they did summer for education. And we're going to start making the summer a learning summer, so the first 4 months of school year are not making up for what you lost on June 10th to August 1st.
I want to pick up on this, because I think, first of all, the fact that we all communicate and look for models is extraordinarily important, because it is a collaborative exercise in a good and healthy way. I went out to Cincinnati a couple of years ago and saw variations on what my colleagues are saying, the community school model they have out there, where there's physical health programs in schools. There's also mental health programs in schools, something that is not talked about enough, again, in our public debate. In Cincinnati, they're finding a way to do it. They have the union actively involved, the teachers' union actively involved supporting community schools. They have the corporate sector actively involved in supporting community schools. So in a sense, when you look around and you look at what your colleagues are doing, you start to see, and this gets to your question about the politics, our job is to transcend the politics. In some ways, I'll borrow again from the laid-back Rahm Emanuel. Sometimes we have to blow by the politics and reframe the discussion. That is, I always remind people that leaders are supposed to lead somewhere, supposed to show people a path. The educational debate is so typically broken, and I thought Eric said it beautifully. You got the two theoretically diametrically opposed forces that if they actually got back to the kids and what would help the kids might actually agree. But it gets taken up to a level of a kind of intense, dramatic debate that obscures meaning and obscures what's happening at the grassroots. My bottom line is for all of us as leaders, we have to blow by that, cut through that, and come up with things on the ground that actually work. And then it's a little bit of if you build it, they will come. And I think there's great examples that each of these guys have achieved. If you start showing that things can work on the ground, if you engage parents, and by the way, this is another piece of the discussion that's wildly under-discussed. You want to have a debate about charter schools, you can get that going anywhere. You want to have a debate about the role of parents in education. I always say parents are the first and last teachers of our children. There's massive value added of engaging parents systematically in their kids' education. And yet in America, a parent-teacher conference is a once-in-a-while drive-by kind of thing without meaning, without strategy. There's not a larger sense of how do we make that a total reality where the parent is constantly connected to the teacher and the school in a healthy, productive way. So it's our job to transcend the politics, in some ways bluntly to ignore the politics, and get this discussion to a healthy place.
Well, I am comforted by your relentless optimism.
I believe you. It sounded very believable.
No. But I. The rubber hits the road at some point, and the details become a little more vexing than simply joining hands and sharing a vision when it gets down to issues like contracts and rules. Mm-hmm. And I just want to move on. You say you share ideas, you share thoughts. Kasim, you confronted a financial crisis when you took over Atlanta. What exactly did you do there, and what lessons are there in that for Rahm and others on this?
Yeah, one of the things that I would add to Bill's comments is it's our job to survive it. So once we do these things, that's the cool thing about being mayor. because politicians like to see somebody, we love being elected, we want to see somebody who did it and survived.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
So when I got elected mayor, between 15-18% of the city's general fund was going to pay pension payments. And I only got elected by 714 votes. And I got elected with the support of labor. And so I win, I sit down, and I have to sign a tax anticipation note loan to make sure that we can meet payroll on my first day in my seat. That's probably the best
thing
that
ever happened. Should have asked
for a recount. I was glad I won. I was really happy. But the point I'm making is that changed me. And I got the business community, labor, all around the table, and I turned our pension challenge into a math problem. We were headed towards insolvency. Our pension costs had gone from $50 million a year to $144 million a year. They were growing at 13% annually, and all of the other revenue was falling off a cliff. And worse than that, we had had to fire about 1,500 to 2,000 employees, David, to pay the pension off. Now in Georgia, two things happen when you don't meet your pension payments. First, they take your sales tax. Second, they take your charter. So there was no discussion about what was getting ready to happen, but I kept explaining. I did 100 speeches, I met with 4,000 employees, and I told them, you want to do a pension reform deal with me. You don't want to do a pension reform deal with some with a bankruptcy court.
That's right.
Because I actually do care about labor. So where are we today? We passed the most sweeping pension reform of a large city in the United States. Our employees and our city council passed it 15-0. Two labor unions were on board. We saved $270 million over 10 years, $500 million over 30. I took the savings, we stopped firing employees, we balanced the budget four times, we grew cash reserves from $7.4 million to $135 million, and all of our rating agencies have given us upgrades across the platforms. And our employees get to go home on Christmas without worrying about me firing them to pay the pension arc. Oh. And the big deal, and so, I know that Rahm's going to be reelected, but what I point out to him, David, no, I know he is. He's my man. But the point I'm making is this. I barely won in 2010 with 714 votes. My first year as mayor was the worst year of my career trying to pass pension reform. Mm-hmm. I had people that had gone door to door with me who would walk past me in a grocery store and wouldn't speak. You can tell how you're doing in the grocery store. But in November, I got reelected with 84% of the vote, won every precinct in the city of Atlanta. Because we did what mayors do.
Right.
Which is turn into the fire. And we did hard things. And I came to the University of Chicago this week really to talk to young folks because I want young people to be involved in cities. Mm-hmm. When you get on a plane, you don't go to France, you go to Paris. You don't go to the UK, you go to London. You go to Dubai. Cities is where the action is. And this conversation isn't just occurring on this campus at the University of Chicago.
Yeah, that's right.
So I hope that you care about it, and I hope that you all help us take this conversation forward, because this is where the health and vitality of America is, right here in this room with these folks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, look. I think, you know, Kasim and I have talked a lot on the pension issue. And the thing is, look, we did a deal with, first of all, I said, you're going to have to deal with this. And I didn't get labor support because I talked about that. Because I thought that if you didn't confront it, it was going to steal the future. You have to do it in a very respectful way. We then tried to do something with the sergeants. We negotiated, got an agreement, but it went down. I then went to the Park District and we did Park District employees. I think there's a fundamental. Now, there are some people on the debate that say, you know, the public employees just get too much. The fact is, that's not true. You're dealing with people's expectations, they negotiate it. There are a lot of decisions made over the last couple decades that deferred the future.
That's
Right.
And that's now come here. Every one of us are now dealing with deferred decisions. Delay. It's come forward. The one thing I tell everybody now is not every park district employee goes and gets a pay stub. They get that pay stub knowing they got a retirement check. It's a big difference. I want to give that to you. Now, there's only four or five parts that make this up. It's not like something behind a tree. To get what you want, you're going to have to contribute more, work more, and it can't grow as fast as you thought, and we're going to have to step on our, up on our side, on the public side. If you give taxpayers the certainty and the employees the certainty, both parties will get it, you'll get there. But this is a fundamental issue to our fiscal side. The most important thing we'll all face, and I think we, I don't want to put words in my colleague's mouth, is education. But it will impact that, because at some point it's going to come out of a classroom too. And you got to do it in a way people, and that is a classic, and to pick up on what Bill said, where the debate gets lost, it gets polarized, it gets politicized. You get in a discussion, I still do what I call Target town halls. Just walk the aisles of Target, looking like you're wandering. Walmart walk-ins, but you can find what people are thinking. They want a solution to these problems.
That's right.
They know there's, you get people away talking one-on-one, they'll tell you they know there's gonna be changes. And change is the only constant in our lives. But it is the toughest challenge a city faces today, because both the federal government's walked away, the states have walked away from assistance. You're trying to make major investments in human resources, our education, our community colleges, our parks, our investments, our libraries, at the same time that the biggest thing we face now is a fiscal challenge with no aid or assistance. And one thing Kasim and I and Eric talked about, is our healthcare costs of the city when I was running was rising at 10% a year. Third biggest item in the budget, it was the fastest growing, and our taxes weren't growing like that, or our revenue rather. So we have dealt with the largest now wellness plan in the country. On the six chronic illnesses, where 6% of the workforce was driving almost 2/3 of the cost just on weight, diabetes, smoking, cardiovascular. We've gotten our healthcare costs finally under control. We're now having the contracts we negotiated require payment for the first time for early retirees, pre-Medicare. And we dealt with the Corshak class, which was unique to Chicago, on that retirement. So our health care costs get lost in the discussion on pension, but are driving a fiscal train, just like for the federal government and everybody else, that have to be managed, still providing people, but in a way that you can afford it. And it's the biggest fiscal challenge we have.
We're running out of time, and I want to get some questions. So. The last thing I want to ask you guys about, I was sort of fascinated that nobody on this panel mentioned crime when I said, what is your biggest challenge? It is a good thing, although there are communities in every one of your cities where there's still, the reality is still a violent reality, which goes to the ability to educate children and do all the other things we want. I mean, this is not just a problem of the schools themselves, but communities as well. And how big a problem is it still? How do you manage it? In your case, Bill, you've taken a rather celebrated program, the Stop and Frisk program in New York, and you're adapting it. And what is your level of comfort that you can do that and not risk an increase in crime?
I knew all along that when we brought police and community back together, when we ended the division that the overuse of stop and frisk had created, that we would actually make ourselves safer. Because I had heard from beat cops that being forced to stop people who were innocent, almost 90% of the folks who were stopped, by the way, under that policy were innocent in every way, shape, or form, according to police statistics. So the endless stopping of large numbers of innocent people was creating a rift between police and community. It was reducing the communication, the partnership, the flow of information that allowed the police to be effective. So now what's happened? Just over 2 months on the job, murders are down almost 20% the first 2 months of this year compared to last year. Shootings are down. The relationship between police and community is beginning to heal. And what we're hearing constantly from the police is they're getting that greater cooperation in the process from folks at the community level. I was with, just in this last week, a good Samaritan who helped the cops stop an attack on a woman late at night, and there was an atmosphere of palpable partnership that was starting to develop there. We had a police shooting. God, thank God the police officer who was shot by an assailant is going to be okay. But neighborhood residents immediately ran to his aid. They immediately helped the police to find where the perpetrator had gone. This is the city we want to create, where there's that fundamental bond between police and community, and it is making us safer. So I'm thrilled that I didn't have to come in here and talk first about crime, because we're making a lot of progress. That being said, for people in neighborhoods that are still experiencing way too much crime, it's one of the most fundamental issues. If they don't feel secure, a lot of other things aren't possible. So I would say that what I think a lot of us are experiencing is we're finding great ways to drive crime down with community residents, as opposed to, for example, an issue like education, which is ubiquitous, which is a challenge almost across the board. Thank God we're able to make crime something we can focus on a little more narrowly. But you never, I'd say this, I bet all my colleagues agree, you never take your eye off the crime situation. And you constantly have to be vigilant. And the minute you see a trend, I have the great honor of having Bill Bratton as my police commissioner.
That's father, true of many of you here, I guess.
Well, great, right, that's right, have had. But one of the things that one of the great innovators of the broken windows theory, and the notion you don't let small negative trends get going. If you see small problems, they turn into big problems, you've got to address them at the root moment, at a root cause. And we've been doing that in New York, so thank God.
But it's also true that in each of these cities, and Ram, you dealt with a major crime issue when you arrived here, that investment in policing is also a part, and each one of you are dealing with that. Kasim, you as well.
When you're doing public safety, you have to practice the politics of the soft and the hard. So I'm never just strong. So I hired 800 police officers, built the biggest police force in the history of the city of Atlanta. Crime is at 40-year lows. It's down 18 points since I've been mayor. But at the exact same time that we had the surge in terms of our police force and police protection, we went and opened every single recreation center in the city of Atlanta. We had $5 million in private philanthropy, build them up. And at the exact same time, we went from seeing 150 kids a week to about 1,800 kids a week. And teen crime is down by 25%. And that's a young man or a woman, primarily a young black man, that doesn't have a police record, because I have safe havens where they can go and spend their days as opposed to getting involved in the penal system. But anybody that wants to have an old debate about more police don't matter, they don't know what they're talking about. And police protection is always on our mind.
Right here.
It's probably the most fundamental thing that we face. I mean, I'm sure we all get it on our phones whenever there's a homicide. We get the steady drumbeat. And we know, I can say that, you know, same thing, you know, our per capita crime hasn't been this low in Los Angeles since 1949, when Truman was president. I can say that, you know, you actually have a lower homicide rate in New York, but part one, violent crime, we're now the safest city per capita in America. And that's been a combination of, yes, building up police forces, the historic high, it's technology, and I think it's not just demographic trends, that's a piece of it, but that so many cities use CompStat and have a technology to policing, and it is those intervention programs. You know, I had a 16-year-old girl when I was a city council member who was walking two blocks from a closed park in the summertime at 6:30 in the evening. Somebody rolled up behind her, no gang history, no criminal history, and shot her in the back and killed her while she was holding her boyfriend's hand. You know, doing what teenagers do. And I think we've all experienced those moments where there's just tragedy beyond what you can imagine, but that one hit me so hard that summer we started, I said, two blocks away, how could a park have been closed? And I said I wanted to open that park in the summertime in the evening. And the police department said, don't do it. It's going to be a place where gangs will congregate, where you're going to have violence. I said, we have to do something different. And the night that we opened up the program, there was art and athletics and academics. After we did our press conference, the politicians in the suits, this young man said, do you mind if I say something? And he was about this tall. And I said, you know, somebody with that kind of courage is 14 years old, come up. He could barely see over the top of the podium. And he brought the microphone down and he said, I'm a tagger. And I was like, oh, great. Who did I just invite to the say something? I said, I spray paint people's, you know, sidewalks and homes. I'm like, this is going really, really well. He said, but before tonight, he said, I don't like doing that. But before tonight, because of the art program, nobody had ever given me a canvas. Mm. And tonight, I got to be an artist. And so that young man transformed his life. That summer, 40% drop in crime. We went from one park to eight parks to 16 parks. We're in 32 parks, private sector, foundation stepping up. And I know part of the reason we're at that 1949 level is because of summer night lights, which we brought to the cities. We've actually imported this to Central America. and in Mexico. We're looking around the world now as really that model. We even have a predictive tool we use with the University of Southern California to help kids at a younger age see which ones are the most likely to join gangs and give them extra attention instead of just throwing our limited resources out, you know, like a bunch of seeds. We are able to do it much more surgically. But it is all of those things together. And even though we didn't talk about it, I think it's part of the greatness of our cities that we've learned to attack public safety, because 30 years ago, this would have been, probably the whole panel would have been about this. We have changed those perceptions tremendously.
David, I want to,
go ahead. And then I'm supposed to end right now, but I would really, really be remiss if I didn't take some questions. So
they may go after you if that happens. So
yes.
I'm going to be real quick, though. As you know, because here, now we are, last year we beat it back in the sense of going after crime, and I want to speak about this in the sense we're at a 67 low on crime and 71 on homicides. Our shootings went down 25%, but among youth, 40%. Mm-hmm. And the biggest part, and it speaks here, is about we increased our summer jobs, 20,000 kids, not one of them a victim of gun violence. We increased our after school by 26% up to 16,000 kids. You know about the BAM program the president highlighted with a child from High Park High School, introduced them. It's a mentoring program teaching these kids right from wrong and that they have something positive to give, what they're missing. And to finish on, I want to make 2 points in all that intervention. And I now say when we deal with crime, Gary McCarthy has to be there with Evelyn Diaz from Family Services. The entire crime debate is always about how many cops you have. It's important. What they're doing is also valuable. How they interact and build relationships is important. But it has to be combined. We call it soft. I call it making sure kids are on the right side, getting the type of mentoring that they never got before, and getting them there. Now, when I opened up with Isaiah Thomas, 12 mm-hmm. basketball courts across the city, Friday, Saturday night, uniforms, coach, timekeeper, adults. Started in Austin neighborhood, Columbus Park out on the west side. So I went there. And saw these kids playing basketball. There's one child, not a child, adolescent. And I started talking to him. And I couldn't get up because he was so engaging. And I'm waiting 20 minutes and he's really engaging. So I finally asked for a card and I write a note to, I said, Mom, from one parent to another, you done well. I got 3 teenagers at home. You're really done well.
I thought the end of the story was going to be, he said, I used to be a tagger in Los Angeles.
I said that about this time.
That's good.
And about 20 minutes later when I'm leaving, he's walking out. I said, where are you going? He says, I'm going home. He says, well, get in the car. It's Friday night. I'll drive you home. Now, remember, he came to play basketball Friday night. He's got a mayor, 2 Tahoes, and 4 Chicago cops. Not a bad deal. We drive the 10 blocks to his house. I'm getting out to walk him the apartment front door. He grabs my hand. He goes, Mr. Mayor. I go, yeah, Martell. He goes, may you have a blessed evening. These are really good kids. They just need an opportunity, canvas, a basketball court, a summer job with a paycheck where they have some self-worth.
That's right.
And you don't get a 40% reduction just because you put a police officer on a corner. Mm-hmm. Very important. You get an investment that gives them an opportunity. Now, I want to pick up on one thing, though, David, and challenge you.
I wish you wouldn't, but
I'm going to, no.
I just feel like I want to get...
I know, but you said this thing that all you guys talked about education.
Huh?
You said all of us just talked about education. And you didn't talk about crime. I would say that the problem we have on education, this is where we're not thinking short-term, we're all thinking long-term.
That's right.
Too long, our schools have become a pipeline to the criminal justice system because they weren't doing their job. And there's the reason you feel this sense of urgency is to make sure that there's not another generation lost with this education, because not one of us would be sitting here. And I include you if we didn't have, A, the love of our parents and a good education. And the problem is, for too often, the education system and our schools weren't doing the task they were set to give these kids the opportunities to do what they needed to do.
Can I invite a couple of questions here?
Hi, first off, thank you all so much for coming here. And I think one thing we all got, especially from this panel, is each of you has a really different style. And I bet that also goes out to how you've been governing as mayors of your cities. And I was wondering if maybe you could talk a little bit about how your personal style has either has either helped or hurt in getting your agendas done? Thank you.
Well, you know, I'll take it up first, because when Kasim was speaking, I'm so glad you brought that up, because we could have had a discussion just about policy all day. And I think at the end of the day, who a mayor is how they're going to do. And so much of it comes down to that negotiation of saying, look, this is a math problem. Those workers, the leaders of those unions, had to trust this man. I had a similar experience with my workers. I was city council president at the time. But if they didn't sit down, if they say, we don't trust you, it doesn't matter what the numbers say. You won't get there. You know, we have very different styles, but I think we also represent kind of the scope of America. I mean, when I think about, we have to be culturally fluent, and I think that's something across personalities that we have, that we embody. I mean, I have an Italian last name. I'm half Mexican, half Jewish. It's like as if, you know, Bill and Rahm had a kid on a Mexican holiday. That's me. And we all have to.
We could actually, that would help us electorally.
Yeah, sure it would. Sure it would. It'd be a very romantic weekend.
That's right. I can't think of a nicer person to have a kid with.
But we have to rely on
What you say in Chicago, I'm sure it stays in Chicago. Yeah, I'll never make it to LA.
I like it. But we have to have those moments. And I think they're as different as we might seem on the cover.
Do you want to be adopted?
One of the things that links the four of us together is underneath that, I think we're driven in the same way. A real sense of urgency, whether you have term limits or not, three of us do, one doesn't. I think you feel that clock ticking. Two, the experience is that when you get into this position, it's very easy. There's a bubble that comes around you, right? You have a security detail. You know, you could very easily live in your office, move from event to event that's scripted. If you don't get out there and live on the street, if you don't go to the Target, if you don't talk to that young man, way past when your staff says, please leave, you won't feel and taste and know your city. But I get a sense that the four of us are pretty united by making sure we stay grounded, by having that sense of urgency, by having the cultural fluency to be able to talk to a homeless person or to the richest person in our town and to figure out how we connect them. And then at the end of the day, personality is less important than the heart that you have there and the soul that you bring to this job. And I'm really excited to be leading a city in this America with leaders like this alongside.
Mm-hmm. Sure. So who's,
Jen is.
Oh, I see.
Hi. So you just mentioned at the end of your response, homelessness. Me and one of my friends work on homelessness as community organizers from the University of Chicago. And I'm wondering, as mayors, what new and innovative ways are you looking to help the most vulnerable in our cities, whether that be getting jobs or finding a place to stay overnight in the cold?
Well, look, I would just say this gets to the root causes. In New York City, the homelessness crisis is directly related to the lack of opportunity that has set in and the cost of housing, obviously. And so we are going at those root causes. We have a systematic effort to increase wages and benefits in as many ways as we can, but we also have a 10-year effort to create 200,000 units of affordable housing. And we know in the short term, by the way, it's a sad reality in New York City, we have over 50,000 people in our shelter system. We have a growing problem with homeless and runaway youth, which we're devoting some very targeted resources to, because this means, and this is something as a parent that really pulls at me, kids in many cases put out of their own home. In many cases, who happen to be LGBT and are rejected by their own parents, it's a tragedy as a parent. I don't know what kind of parent could do that to their child, but it's happening every day in our city. So we know that part of this is reaching our young people who are homeless in a special way, giving them a special place they can be, that they are safe from other realities. But the macro reality we face is we got to go at the root causes. If we succeed in creating a large amount of new affordable housing, if we succeed in pushing up wages and benefits, and in the short term, we do some things to prevent homelessness, things like anti-eviction legal services and rent subsidies that are targeted to keep people in their apartment when they're right on the verge of losing it economically. I think we can really turn it around, but it's something that has to be led aggressively from City Hall.
Let me give you two populations and then examples. One is we have a huge domestic violence problem, as every city.
That's right.
It's one of the biggest calls that actually police officers have. I made a change at the Department of Family Services, allow the Catholic Charities to take over an aspect of social services, saves us about $2.5 million. And we're building our first domestic violence shelter in the city in a decade, but allows for families. And when I say it allows for families, big problem is when you invite a mother in and they have a son, where do you put the child?
That's right.
And the biggest problem with a mother to leave the house of violence is you have a family, how do you provide for them? So we made a change, had a fight about it, but gave the basic service to Catholic Charities took the savings and then plowed it into a new investment, which is domestic violence, so it will be open in October. Second is ex-offenders. You don't want an ex-offender to be a repeat offender, a job. It's the only way they can clean up their resume. So we've made changes, and now I have a requirement, not just in the city, CTA, CHA, all the sister agencies, they have to give me a plan of what they're going to do on the ex-offender population in hiring. Because if you want to change violence, you can't have an ex-offender coming out of jail without an opportunity to prove that they can be responsible. And the only way to get them from ex-offender to not repeat offender, and having the criminal justice system just become a revolving door, is a job. That's their resume. And we have different ways in the sister agencies in the city now. The CTA has one of the largest ex-offender programs of any public transportation system in the country. That's the two kind of changes. And I make them report what they're going to do and how they're going to grow it over the time and make changes. But I want to say leadership. David, because this gets...
You're killing me, man.
I know. Well, that started about 30 years ago when you worked for Roosevelt. The thing is, though, in both those cases, you had to be willing to take on public sector unions, and I don't mean that we're doing the other jobs, and you just saw this in the transportation space, but give that opportunity to ex-offenders. And we just did that here in the city of Chicago.
This question sort of picks up on the job, and I'm very pleased to hear about the ex-offender program, because I'm wondering about programs have in inclusive economic development. Where we go from looking at the areas of the city where you have highest unemployment, highest conviction rates, lowest, educational attainment, and how do we sort of change the paradigm so that we're not looking at them as places we're fixing and sort of bringing programming to, but have untapped value and assets, mm-hmm. and have inclusive economic development to really get, no education is going to help unless there's jobs for people in those communities that are hardest to serve and the people that are hardest to reach.
There's a lot of talk about food deserts, and nutrition, and I think we really need to look at job deserts. And the idea that you do have people who today in communities that used to have jobs right there within a couple blocks of their homes, at least in my city, and I dare say in all these cities, there's these huge deserts out there. I've made an active effort to bring in, that's also where there's industrial land quite often still, and it's cheap. And if you go to Los Angeles, I don't know about the cost in Chicago, it's 40% less than New York or San Francisco. So, you're able to come in at a cheap rate. Bill's doing, I think, a lot of great focus on this, too, to make sure that it starts earlier. But we have to make sure that you're right, you're not just coming in. We were chosen as a promise zone, one of the first three cities by President Obama, to layer a lot of federal programs together. That's exciting, but it's less exciting to me than the idea of taking this promise zone and looking at what we can do to bring companies in there. With very surgical workforce development things. So I go to this high school and say, this is where computer coding is. By the way, we also just brought some of our dark fiber that my utility, the largest municipal utility in the country owns, and you'll have the best high-speed internet connection in this country. Don't you want to have your company right here? So a cosmetic company that wasn't there, 3 years ago, didn't exist, has 300 people that are hired primarily in a 10-block radius because it's an easier place to hire from. So I think you're right. It's also the land use policy. So we're not just coming in with all these anti-poverty policies that kind of reify the idea these are poor places that need help.
I've got to stop. Oh, I'm sorry.
Kasim.
Just quickly, the other thing is to slow down and plan with instead of plan on. And your personal presence matters. And it's really hard as busy as mayors are, but when you're dealing with that kind of challenge, your presence in meetings and doing as many meetings as are necessary to improve people's comfort level, and then going through the hardship of listening to all of that and making it a part of the final product, I think is just essential.
Let me just say, we're way over. The mayor has to get to the airport. You probably have to get to the airport, I'm not sure, but I don't want you to have to speed to get to the airport.
We're not speeding.
But listen, but since our speed cameras put the money in early childhood, go ahead.
It would be a patriotic act.
Just give them the cash.
That's right.
But I have to say that as we look at cities are dynamic places. They've got wonderful, wonderful promise and great activity and great challenges. And it's really, really exciting to see four leaders who are so animated by these challenges. Makes me feel really positive about the future of our cities. So we're really grateful for your presence here tonight.
Thank you very much for that.
And the real debate isn't about charter versus neighborhood. The debate is quality versus failure. That's where the debate is on education. And as Kasim said, we have to adopt anything that gets you to quality. And it's not about the means, it's about the end. And there's a set, you cannot, this is where Atlanta, being the home of Dr. King, and on education, the civil rights movement began with education, the fierce urgency of now. Mm-hmm. And we cannot allow the politics to get in the way of giving having another generation because it was too politically difficult.
Now let me ask a blunt question. When you guys talk about the politics, I feel like we're being euphemistic about this. Is this a labor issue, a union issue? Is that, what exactly are the political barriers to reform?
Well, you know, if you put together, David, the most pro-charter, conservative school reformer, in quotes, with the most active union, hardcore activist, and get them for a moment to say, what does a good school look like? They'll have an identical conversation.
That's right.
So we are losing all of our time saying, are you pro-charter or anti-charter?
Yeah, it's a wrong
Are you for
debate.
Teacher unions or against teacher unions? You know, I'm for charter schools, and I was endorsed by the teachers union, and both were confused. They said, oh, we don't know if we can trust him. Well, I got elected mayor, so I guess it's okay.
That's right.
But the point was, I think
it's
there's
all
three
the
things. Exactly.
It goes to your head.
There's three things. Early ed, consensus. Great campuses, a consensus. And let me go a little more in detail. Every campus should have a health clinic in it. You have an undiagnosed medical condition, mental or physical, you can't learn. Every ball field should be an after-school space, joint use between cities and school districts. Make sure we have more than one counselor for 3,000 kids like we do in my city, so we can get kids to college. So build great campuses. And then the third piece is align curriculum with jobs. And it isn't rocket science. You know, in the past, you'd go to a shop class because you then were going to get a factory job in aerospace and live a middle-class life in Los Angeles. Well, today, we're creating a new tech firm, digital tech firm, every 40 hours. After Silicon Beach and Tel Aviv, we're rated number 3 in the world right now. And watch out, Tel Aviv, because we're coming. So we have the ability to hire people right now without a college degree, $70,000 starting salary if you know computer coding. So in South Los Angeles, I'm starting an initiative called Silicon South, which will allow us to take, and we've already started two schools, Dorsey High School and Crenshaw High School, among our poorest and lowest performing high schools, where we have computer science teachers in there. This past summer, 10 kids created 34 smartphone apps. The White House honored them. They are going to be the founders of great companies, as well as getting great jobs. We've been so scared of vocational education as a term for so long, of tracking kids, that we've forgotten this is actually where the middle class prosperity is, whether it's in aerospace, whether it's in digital technology, or whether it's in the healthcare industry. We've got to align our education system with that, using the community college districts. And one last thing, I'm really proud of what ROM's done here, and we're looking to emulate it in Los Angeles, is take the summer and make sure kids get ahead during the summer. Do a summer of learning program, do a summer jobs program for youth. It's something that I put most
don't
of my political
cap. Don't jump in the lake if they read 2 million books. That's my rule. If you're going to come up with a number, challenge the kids on
Los
a big
Angeles,
number.
Jumping in the ocean is so nice, I'll happily do that
no,
in Los
but,
Angeles.
I
can't believe you walked into that.
I do want to say, he heard about our summer learning. And what we did with our libraries, with ROM's readers, and what they did, our Park District summer camp, he immediately sent people, and this is one thing, we all learn from each other.
That's what I do.
And he's got a variation that now I want to look at what we're doing. And so my point is, we did this summer learn because there's a summer slide.
Yep.
You can't get a year-round education. Kids need a year-round education. So we instituted this summer learning and challenged kids on books and reading and learning and have a digital badge that they get. MacArthur paid for it, foundation. And my ultimate goal, and we were talking about this today, is in 4 years, when a child shows up to school, they're gonna show up with their medical records, and they're gonna show up with their electronic badges and tell you what they did summer for education. And we're gonna start making the summer a learning summer, so the first 4 months of school year are not making up for what you lost on June 10th to August 1st.
I wanna pick up on this, because I think, first of all, the fact that we all communicate and look for models is extraordinarily important, because it is a collaborative exercise in a good and healthy way. I went out to Cincinnati a couple of years ago and saw variations on what my colleagues are saying, the community school model they have out there, where there's physical health programs in schools. There's also mental health
Yes.
programs in schools, something that is not talked about enough, again, in our public debate. In Cincinnati, they're finding a way to do it. They have the union actively involved, the teachers union actively involved supporting community schools. They have the corporate sector actively involved in supporting community schools. So in a sense, when you look around and you look at what your colleagues are doing, you start to see, and this gets to your question about the politics, our job is to transcend the politics. In some ways, I'll borrow again from the laid-back Rahm Emanuel, sometimes we have to blow by the politics and reframe the discussion. That is, I always remind people that leaders are supposed to lead somewhere, supposed to show people a path. The educational debate is so typically broken, and I thought Eric said it beautifully. You got the two theoretically diametrically opposed forces that if they actually got back to the kids and what would help the kids might actually agree. But it gets taken up to a level of a kind of intense, dramatic debate that obscures meaning and obscures what's happening at the grassroots. My bottom line is for all of us as leaders, we have to blow by that, cut through that, and come up with things on the ground that actually work. And then it's a little bit of if you build it, they will come. And I think there's great examples that each of these guys have achieved. If you start showing that things can work on the ground, if you engage parents, and by the way, this is another piece of discussion that's wildly under-discussed. You want to have a debate about charter schools, you can get that going anywhere. You want to have a debate about the role of parents in education. I always say parents are the first and last teachers of our children. There's massive value added of engaging parents systematically in their kids' education. And yet in America, a parent-teacher conference is a once-in-a-while drive-by kind of thing without meaning, without strategy. There's not a larger sense of how do we make that a total reality where the parent is constantly connected to the teacher and the school in a healthy, productive way. So it's our job to transcend the politics, in some ways bluntly to ignore the politics, and get this discussion to a healthy place.
Well, I am comforted by your relentless optimism.
I believe you. It sounded very believable.
No. But I. It's the rubber hits the road at some point, and the details become a little more vexing than simply joining hands and sharing a vision when it gets down to issues like contracts and rules. Mm-hmm. I just want to move on. You say you share ideas, you share thoughts. Kasim, you confronted a financial crisis when you took over Atlanta. What exactly did you do there, and what lessons are there in that for Rahm and others on this?
Yeah, one of the things that I would add to Bill's comments is it's our job to survive it. So once we do these things,
world, yeah.
That's the cool thing about being mayor. Because politicians like to see somebody, we love being elected, we want to see somebody who did it and survived.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
So when I got elected mayor, between 15 to 18% of the city's general fund was going to pay pension payments. And I only got elected by 714 votes. And I got elected with the support of labor. And so I sit down and I have to sign a tax anticipation note loan to make sure that we can meet payroll on my first day in my seat. That's probably the best
thing
that ever
happened.
Should
have asked
for a recount. I was glad I won. I was really happy. But the point I'm making is that changed me. And I got the business community, labor, all around the table, and I turned our pension challenge into a math problem. We were headed towards insolvency. Our pension costs had gone from $50 million a year to $144 million a year. They were growing at 13% annually, and all of the other revenue was falling off a cliff. And worse than that, we had to fire about 1,500 to 2,000 employees, David, to pay the pension off. Now in Georgia, two things happen when you don't meet your pension payments. First, they take your sales tax. Second, they take your charter. So there was no discussion about what was getting ready to happen, but I kept explaining. I did 100 speeches. I met with 4,000 employees, and I told them, you want to do a pension reform deal with me. You don't want to do a pension reform deal with a bankruptcy court.
That's right.
Because I actually do care about labor. So where are we today? We passed the most sweeping pension reform of a large city in the United States. Our employees and our city council passed it 15-0. Two labor unions were on board. We saved $270 million over 10 years, $500 million over 30. I took the savings, we stopped firing employees, we balanced the budget 4 times, we grew cash reserves from $7.4 million to $135 million, and all of our rating agencies have given us upgrades across the platforms. And our employees get to go home on Christmas without worrying about me firing them to pay the pension arc. And the big deal, so I know that Rahm's going to be reelected, but what I point out to him, David, no, I know he is, he's my man. But the point I'm making is this. I barely won in 2010 with 714 votes. My first year as mayor was the worst year of my career trying to pass pension reform. I had people that had gone door to door with me who would walk past me in a grocery store and wouldn't speak. You can tell how you're doing in the grocery store. But in November, I got reelected with 84% of the vote, won every precinct in the city of Atlanta. Because we did what mayors do, which is turn into the fire. And we did hard things. And I came to the University of Chicago this week really to talk to young folks, because I want young people to be involved in cities. Mm-hmm. When you get on a plane, you don't go to France, you go to Paris. You don't go to the UK, you go to London. You go to Dubai. Cities is where the action is. And this conversation isn't just occurring on this campus at the University of Chicago.
Yeah, that's right.
So I hope that you all care about it, and I hope that you all help us take this conversation forward, because this is where the health and vitality of America is, right here in this room with these folks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, look. I think, you know, Kasim and I have talked a lot on the pension issue. And the thing is, look, we did a deal with, first of all, I said, you're going to have to deal with this. And I didn't get labor support because I talked about that. Because I thought that if you didn't confront it, it was going to steal the future. You have to do it in a very respectful way. We then tried to do something with the sergeants. We negotiated, got an agreement, but it went down. I then went to the Park District, and we did Park District employees. I think there's a fundamental. Now, there are some people on the debate that say, you know, the public employees just get too much. The fact is, that's not true. You're dealing with people's expectations, they negotiate it. There are a lot of decisions made over the last couple decades that deferred the future.
That's right.
And that's now come here. Every one of us are now dealing with deferred decisions. Delay. It's come forward. The one thing I tell everybody now is not every Park District employee goes and gets a pay stub. They get that pay stub knowing they got a retirement check. It's a big difference. I want to give that to you. Now, there's only four or five parts that make this up. It's not like something behind a tree. To get what you want, you're gonna have to contribute more, work more, and it can't grow as fast as you thought, and we're gonna have to step on our side, on the public side. If you give taxpayers the certainty and the employees the certainty, both parties will get it, you'll get there. But this is a fundamental issue to our fiscal side. The most important thing we'll all face, and I don't want to put words in my colleague's mouth, is education. But it will impact that, because at some point it's going to come out of a classroom too. And you got to do it in a way that is a classic, and to pick up on what Bill said, where the debate gets lost, it gets polarized, it gets politicized. You get in a discussion, I still do what I call Target town halls. Just walk the aisles of Target looking like you're wandering. Walmart walk-ins, but you can find what people are thinking. They want a solution to these problems. That's right. They know you get people away talking one-on-one, they'll tell you they know there's gonna be changes. And change is the only constant in our lives. But it is the toughest challenge a city faces today, because both the federal government's walked away, the states have walked away from assistance. You're trying to make major investments in human resources, our education, our community colleges, our parks, our investments, our libraries, at the same time that the biggest thing we face now is a fiscal.
I mean that with absolute appreciation for others, but we take pride in the breadth of what we have. Every kind of community, every kind of nationality and ethnicity, a tremendous creative energy, entrepreneurial energy, obviously one of the global capitals of business, communications, now more and more technology. There's so much happening that people can key into. And I agree with Kasim, you can bring your dreams to New York and you have an immense opportunity to do something with it. And of course, we're the ultimate city of immigrants, and so when I say you can bring your dreams to New York, that means from literally anywhere, and that's the norm in New York. I do think at the same time that we have some things we have to fix in our city. You know, one of the things I said in my campaign is that we're living a tale of two cities in terms of opportunity, and there's some things we have to do to improve the opportunity levels for everyone. Things like pre-K, things like raising up wages and benefits, and we're relentlessly going about that, and it's going to make a difference, I'm convinced. But the core of what New York is about historically is this extraordinary inclusive opportunity and this extraordinary creative energy, and that is stronger than ever.
So, Rahm, you want to take a swing for the home team?
Yeah, I mean, well, your question is directed at you're recruiting a company.
Or not just a company, but a company, a family. Well, what is it that makes Chicago unique and appealing?
Well, first of all, Chicago is the most American of American cities. It is. It's the most American of American cities because we're a city of immigrants. We're not just known as the city of big shoulders, but it's built on the shoulders of immigrants, just like my grandfather came here in 1917 as a 13-year-old by himself, not knowing a word of English. And in a generation, his grandson is mayor, not only in America, but in the city of Chicago. Number two, as I say to businesses on a regular basis, we have now been rated by both IBM and The Economist magazine as the second most competitive economy in all of North America. 35% of the people in the city of Chicago have a four-year college degree or better, and we have the institutions like the University of Chicago and all the others that continue to put highly educated workers into the economy, growing it. And we have more people from the Big Ten state universities than any other city in America, alumni. So the workforce is educated and the institutions to back it up. We have the most connected airport rated, the most connected airport in all of North America, the only one that allows you to get to anywhere in a country or anywhere in the world directly daily, weather permitting, and we're working on that. Third, we have the cultural institutions. We have the number one museum, the most amount of Tony Award-winning theater companies tied with New York, the institution of cultural life. So we have a world-class workforce, a world-class transportation system, and a world-class city to give you and the companies here. Now, just yesterday, Site Magazine cited Chicago as the number one city last year for new corporate headquarters and recruitment and expansions. Because of all the strengths that are built in the city institutionally, we will be as strong, as I said, our downtown district, 2 mile radius around downtown, is the fastest growing central business district in America by a factor of three.
I know she didn't, now, mention, I know she didn't mention the baseball teams.
Okay.
That's a very sensitive topic, David. That's not appropriate.
and the good news is that's good. The standard of the city will be that when you get out that 2 mile radius and a child walking out of a school, a child walking out of a place of worship, a child walking out of their home, regardless of where they are, north, west, or south of this, that downtown, and they can see the energy, they can see the excitement, they can see the promise. Do they think their future is part of that, or do they think their future is only contained to what's in front of them? And we will only be the city we can be if every child, regardless of their perspective of the city, thinks they have a future in this city. And that's how we measure success.
Eric, if you want to add something to what you said before, go ahead. But I do want to get to the challenges. I figured I'd give each of you guys a chance to do a commercial, and then I...
And that was very beautifully said, Rahm. And these are three great cities. If you want to move there, if you want to put your business there, if you want to stay here, please do. But if you want to know why Los Angeles, besides the weather, is such an incredible place, I think Los Angeles has been both a symbol for America as well as the incarnation of kind of the highest ideals of this country. We're creators and we're innovators. We're the western capital of the United States, the northern capital of Latin America, the eastern capital of the Pacific Rim. If we didn't have a city there right now, we'd have to build one simply because of the intersection of these amazing global forces. We've got the highest rate of entrepreneurialism of any city in America. More than one out of 200 Angelenos is an entrepreneur. We've got the industries that you all know about, of course, Hollywood, aerospace. We put, you know, rovers on Mars. During the Olympics, 90 medals during the London Olympics were won by Angelenos, which is two more than China. We would have been second in the world if we were a nation. But we have three top 25 universities, the only city in the country to have three top 25 universities, three top 100 global universities. But I think Los Angeles's challenge is we have such an embarrassment of riches, the weather, the people, the most... No, seriously, hear me out here.
I thought this was going to be short.
Hear me out. Because this is the criticism and this is the challenge piece. We've been almost lazy about putting the pieces together. And I will compliment these gentlemen because I think there's been a stronger civic fabric in other cities. Los Angeles has been a very libertarian place. We always had the weather, we always had the land. We didn't need to do some of the things that cities needed to. And so my challenge as mayor is how do we begin to stitch these pieces together of this immense diversity, 220 languages, 150 countries of origin. 37 countries have their largest population outside their home country in LA. That's never happened before on the face of the earth. But we have to figure out a way to build, I think, and learn from some of our other and older cities how we get that civic fabric to be able to fulfill the dream Ram talked about for that kid.
Okay, we'll vote on your favorite city at the end of the program.
I think it's a little bit rigged. You know?
That's the way we like our
You're
elections.
In Chicago, bro. That's how we do it here.
Typical Chicago election. And by the way, vote as many times as you want. Just keep coming and coming.
But you don't even need to be alive.
But you get just ask how many ballots you want beforehand. We'll give them to you.
Bill began to touch on this. Bill began to touch on this. For all the great advantages that each of your cities offer, you're all faced with challenges and problems. And I'd like you each to talk about what you think the greatest challenge facing your city is. Kasim, you want to?
I think we have two challenges. We have the challenges that many people who live in the city have to pay what I call a private school tax. We're in the middle of transforming our public education system and coming out of one of the worst cheating scandals in America and picking a new leader and working through all of the pain that went with that process in order to make sure that our children have no ceiling on their lives. So that's hard. And then we're
you
also-
You don't have the authority to, you don't-
No, I don't have
an
control,
elected school board.
I don't have the control of the school board, but I've got a pretty big voice in how that happens. And you know, when we had our cheating scandal, I called up the Chancellor of Higher Education for the state of Georgia. He was retiring on a Friday. He was the head of APS on a Monday, our public school system, and his wife hasn't spoken to me since. And so I certainly played a role in stabilizing the system. And then I think the second challenge we have is in the area of infrastructure. The city of Atlanta and the Atlanta Metro got to where it is about 15 years too fast, David. We're now the ninth largest metro in the U.S., 5.9 million people, in the 10th biggest state, and the infrastructure was not built for that. And so at a time when the federal government is reducing what it's prepared to put in, we grew very fast. We were among the four fastest growing metros over the last 2 years. So all of these are problems that are tied to our success, but they're here on our watch, and I've got to figure out how to deal with them at a time when we have less federal support and in a very conservative state overall.
Let's go down the row, and then let's pick up some of these problems. I suspect there's some commonalities between your concerns. So, Bill, you want to?
Sure. I've said throughout my campaign last year the greatest challenge facing New York City is an inequality crisis. And bluntly, I think the inequality crisis in this country is a challenge for all of us. In New York City, we have the greatest income inequality since the Great Depression, since 1929, and getting worse all the time. We have 46% of our people at or near the poverty level. That number would have been inconceivable a decade or two ago. So this is the reality we face in this country. It's been intensified, or the effect has been intensified in our city because of the high cost of living, but let's face it, wages and benefits have been pushed downward over the course of decades. And a lot of what we fundamentally believe in as Americans and the kind of opportunity we think is essential to the nature of this country is being undermined. So I do believe, and I think it picks up on Eric's point about a tradition in each city about what the role of government is and what the civic conversation is. From my point of view, the conversation we had last year in New York City was about inequality and the fact that the government would have to play an active role in addressing it. We're taking steps right now to push wages and benefits up. We just passed, I'm very proud of the fact that working with our city council, we passed a law to provide paid sick leave, paid sick days to 500,000 more people than have it now in New York City. That's a tangible benefit that's going to help people keep money in their pocket and not have the dislocation in their life when they're sick. We're going to do a lot to bring wage levels up, including with all the companies that the city subsidizes and does business with. We want to take the living wage concept and use that to the maximum extent possible to take that public involvement with the private sector and use it to leverage better wage levels. Obviously believe there needs to be an increase in the minimum wage. And we think a city like New York should set its own minimum wage because our cost of living is higher. So there's a lot we have to do on that front. Of course, I think for the long run to address inequality, it runs through education. That's why our very aggressive plan is full-day pre-K for every child in the city, after-school programs for every middle school student, literally every middle school student that needs them, so we extend the school day. We build opportunity for the long run. But we have to fire on all those cylinders if we're going to address what is now an inequality crisis. And it picks up on the point about the dynamics of DC that we're all feeling. We know there is not a cavalry coming right now from Washington. And I think the analogy of what we would have felt if we were sitting on the stage in 1968 or 1978, we would have had a different set of assumptions about partnership. Now it's what can we generate ourselves? We have to build up our economies. You heard everyone's pitch. We have to build up our economies. And then we have to use the tools of government to create more opportunity and to address inequality head on. That's the big challenge.
The you raised the exact right point, which is in the 1960s, there was a steady flow of funds from Washington for the cities. There is no flow now. How much has that made the relationship with state governments more important? You hinted at this before, Kasim, and your relationship with the state government. How much do you rely on the state government, if not for funding, then for the flexibility to do the things that you want to do?
I think flexibility is the key word. It's not cash, it's not resources. But more important than the relationship with the state government, the federal government needs to change its relationship with cities.
Amen.
The federal government is functioning under an outdated model that shifts money to 50 states,
yep,
as opposed to shifting resources to the GDP. So 70% of the country's GDP is in cities that we lead. But despite that fact, we still have to deal with states. So if the federal government wanted to boost productivity in American cities, they would change the old formula and stop forcing us to work through states regarding our resources and send the money directly to us, because we get it to where it is needed faster and more efficiently, and we're more accountable to citizens.
Yeah. Ram, you want to pick up on your...
Look, the problem, we're at a unique moment in American history. Cities are in their renaissance. And at this moment in time, and we talk about 68, I mean, I always, when I first got elected, I said I would love to have been mayor in the late 90s, where cash was everywhere, man.
I wasn't born.
That, so. Yeah. The late 90s?
68.
Oh, yeah.
68.
Oh. Well, you missed a lot.
Yeah, I know.
Okay. So my point, we're in a renaissance, and this gets up, but Washington's AWOL. Totally AWOL. The state capitals have their own, at least if we know here in Illinois, they have huge budgetary problems. And so we are cast on our own in a moment of time where you have to kind of boost the economy, et cetera. I would say to the three challenges, David, that you asked about. One is clear, is first and foremost, which is why, right, is education. You can't have a city, in my view, where you had a graduation rate when I was running, it was in the mid-50s. Now the good news is we're now on track to get to 80% in 4 years. And that means every child, and it's, you know, and those are tough decisions, but, you know, we have now, we used to have the shortest school day in America of any big city. We now have a full school day. We have universal kindergarten for the first time for every child in the city of Chicago, a full school day of kindergarten. And that's the predicate that Bill was talking about, because if you're going to make sure there's great high schools in your city, and we've reinvigorated with IB, International Baccalaureate, STEM, military, other choices for them, you're going to have high schools, but you're going to make sure that we have kids for those high schools can really accomplish. And it does start earlier. I would say in the challenge, with no aid or assistance, and one thing Kasim and I and Eric talked about is our healthcare costs of the city when I was running was rising at 10% a year. Third biggest item in the budget, it was the fastest growing, and our taxes weren't growing like that, or our revenue rather. So we have dealt with the largest now wellness plan in the country. On the six chronic illnesses, where 6% of the workforce was driving almost 2/3 of the cost just on weight, diabetes, smoking, cardiovascular. We've gotten our healthcare costs finally under control. We're now having the contracts we negotiated require payment for the first time for early retirees, pre-Medicare. And we dealt with the CoreShot class, which was unique to Chicago, on that retirement. So our healthcare costs get lost in the discussion on pension, but are driving a fiscal train, just like for the federal government and everybody else, that have to be managed, still providing people, but in a way that you can afford it. And it's the biggest fiscal challenge we have.
We're running out of time, and I want to get some questions. So the last thing I want to ask you guys about, I was sort of fascinated that nobody on this panel mentioned crime when I said, what is your biggest challenge? Well, yeah, it is a good thing, although there are communities in every one of your cities where there's still, the reality is still a violent reality, which goes to the ability to educate children and do all the other things we want. I mean, this is not just a problem of the schools themselves, but communities as well. And how big a problem is it still? How do you manage it? In your case, Bill, you've taken a rather celebrated program, the Stop and Frisk program in New York, and you're adapting it. And what is your level of comfort that you can do that and not risk an increase in crime?
I knew all along that when we brought police and community back together, when we ended the division that the overuse of Stop and Frisk had created, that we would actually make ourselves safer, because I had heard from beat cops that being forced to stop people who were innocent, almost 90% of the folks who were stopped, by the way, under that policy were innocent in every way, shape, or form, according to police statistics. So the endless stopping of large numbers of innocent people was creating a rift between police and community. It was reducing the communication, the partnership, the flow of information that allowed the police to be effective. So now what's happened? Just over 2 months on the job, murders are down almost 20% the first 2 months of this year compared to last year. Shootings are down. The relationship between police and community is beginning to heal. And what we're hearing constantly from the police is they're getting that greater cooperation in the process from folks at the community level. I was with, just in this last week, a Good Samaritan who helped the cops stop an attack on a woman late at night. And there was an atmosphere of palpable partnership that was starting to develop there. We had a police shooting. Thank God the police officer who was shot by an assailant is going to be okay. But neighborhood residents immediately ran to his aid. They immediately helped the police to find where the perpetrator had gone. This is the city we want to create, where there's that fundamental bond between police and community, and it is making us safer. So I'm thrilled that I didn't have to come in here and talk first about crime, because we're making a lot of progress. That being said, for people in neighborhoods that are still experiencing way too much crime, it's one of the most fundamental issues. If they don't feel secure, a lot of other things aren't possible. So I would say that what I think a lot of us are experiencing is we're finding great ways to drive crime down with community residents, as opposed to, for example, an issue like education, which is ubiquitous, which is a challenge almost across the board. Thank God we're able to make crime something we can focus on a little more narrowly. But you never, I'd say this, I bet all my colleagues agree, you never take your eye off the crime situation. And you constantly have to be vigilant. And the minute you see a trend, I have the great honor of having Bill Bratton as my police commissioner.
That's father, true of many of you here, I guess. But,
that's right, have had. But one of the things that one of the great innovators of the broken windows theory, and the notion you don't let small negative trends get going. If you see small problems, they turn into big problems, you've got to address them at the root moment, at a root cause. And we've been doing that in New York, so thank
God.
But
it's also true that in each of these cities, and Ram, you dealt with a major crime issue when you arrived here. That investment in policing is also a part, and each one of you are dealing with that. Kasim, you as well.
When you're doing public safety, you have to practice the politics of the soft and the hard. So I'm never just strong. So I hired 800 police officers, built the biggest police force in the history of the city of Atlanta. Crime is at 40-year lows. It's down 18 points since I've been mayor. But at the exact same time that we had the surge in terms of our police force and police protection, we went and opened every single recreation center in the city of Atlanta. We had $5 million in private philanthropy, build them up. And at the exact same time, we went from seeing 150 kids a week to about 1,800 kids a week. And teen crime is down by 25%. And that's a young man or a woman, primarily a young black man that doesn't have a police record, because I have safe havens where they can go and spend their days as opposed to getting involved in the penal system. But anybody that wants to have an old debate about more police don't matter, they don't know what they're talking about. And police protection is always on our mind.
Right here. It's probably the most fundamental thing that we face. I mean, I'm sure we all get it on our phones whenever there's a homicide. We get the steady drumbeat. And we know, I can say that, same thing. You know, our per capita crime hasn't been this low in Los Angeles since 1949, when Truman was president. I can say that, you know, we go across, you actually have a lower homicide rate in New York, but part one, violent crime, we're now the safest city per capita in America. And that's been a combination of, yes, building up police forces, the historic high, it's technology, and I think it's not just demographic trends, that's a piece of it, but that so many cities use CompStat and have a technology to policing, and it is those intervention programs. You know, I had a 16-year-old girl when I was a city council member who was walking two blocks from a closed park in the summertime at 6:30 in the evening. Somebody rolled up behind her, no gang history, no criminal history, and shot her in the back and killed her while she was holding her boyfriend's hand. You know, doing what teenagers do. And I think we've all experienced those moments where there's just tragedy beyond what you can imagine, but that one hit me so hard that that summer we started, I said, two blocks away, how could a park have been closed? And I said I wanted to open that park in the summertime in the evening. And the police department said, don't do it. It's going to be a place where gangs will congregate, where you're going to have violence. I said, we have to do something different. And the night that we opened up the program, there was you know, art and athletics and academics. This, after we did our press conference, the politicians in the suit, this young man said, do you mind if I say something? And he was about this tall. And I said, you know, somebody with that kind of courage who's 14 years old come up. He could barely see over the top of the podium. And he brought the microphone down and he said, I'm a tagger. I was like, oh, great. Who did I just invite to the say something? I said, I spray paint people's, you know, sidewalks and homes. I'm like, this is going really, really well. He said, but before tonight, he said, I don't like doing that. But before tonight, because of the art program, nobody had ever given me a canvas. And tonight, I got to be an artist. And so that young man transformed his life. That summer, 40% drop in crime. We went from one park to eight parks to 16 parks. We're in 32 parks, private sector, foundation stepping up. And I know part of the reason we're at that 1949 level is because of summer nightlights, which we brought to the cities. We've actually imported this to Central America and in Mexico. We're looking around the world now as really that model. We even have a predictive tool we use with the University of Southern California to help kids at a younger age see which ones are the most likely to join gangs and give them extra attention instead of just throwing our limited resources out, you know, like a bunch of seeds. We are able to do it much more surgically. But it is all of those things together. And even though we didn't talk about it, I think it's part of the greatness of our cities that we've learned to attack public safety, because 30 years ago, this would have been, probably the whole panel would have been about this.
Right.
We have changed those perceptions tremendously.
David, I want to,
go ahead, and then I'm supposed to end right now, but I would really, really be remiss if I didn't take some questions. So
they may go after you if that happens. So
yes.
I'm going to be real quick, though. As you know, because here, now we are, last year we beat it back in the sense of going after crime, and I want to speak about this in the sense we're at a 67 low on crime and 71 on homicides. Our shootings went down 25%, but among youth, 40%. And the biggest part, and it speaks here, is about we increased our summer jobs, 20,000 kids, not one of them a victim of gun violence. Mm-hmm. We increased our after school by 26% up to 16,000 kids. You know about the BAM program the president highlighted with a child from Hyde Park High School, introduced them. It's a mentoring program teaching these kids right from wrong and that they have something positive to give, what they're missing. And to finish on, I want to make two points in all that intervention. And I now say, when we deal with crime, Gary McCarthy has to be there with Evelyn Diaz from Family Services. The entire crime debate is always about how many cops you have. It's important. What they're doing is also valuable. How they interact and build relationships is important. But it has to be combined. We call it soft. I call it making sure kids are on the right side, getting the type of mentoring that they never got before, and getting them there. Now, when I opened up with Isaiah Thomas, 12 mm-hmm. basketball courts across the city, Friday, Saturday night, uniforms, coach, timekeeper, adults. Started in Austin neighborhood, Columbus Park out on the west side. So I went there. I saw these kids playing basketball. There's one child, not a child, adolescent. And I started talking to him. And I couldn't get up because he was so engaging. And I'm waiting 20 minutes, and he's really engaging. So I finally asked for a card, and I write a note. I said, Mom, from one parent to another, you done well. I got three teenagers at home. I mean, you're really done well.
I thought the end of the story was going to be, he said, I used to be a tagger in Los Angeles.
I said
it
about this time.
That's good.
And About 20 minutes later, when I'm leaving, he's walking out. I said, where are you going? He says, I'm going home. He says, well, get in the car. It's Friday night. I'll drive you home. Now, remember, he came to play basketball Friday night. He's got a mayor, two Tahoes, and four Chicago cops. Not a bad deal. We drive the 10 blocks to his house. I'm getting out to walk him to the apartment front door. He grabs my hand. He goes, Mr. Mayor. I go, yeah, Martell. He goes, may you have a blessed evening. Hmm. These are really good kids. They just need an opportunity, That's a right. canvas, a basketball court, yep. a summer job with a paycheck where they have some self-worth.
That's right.
And you don't get a 40% reduction just because you put a police officer on a corner. Mm-hmm. Very important. You get an investment that gives them an opportunity. Now, I want to pick up on one thing, though, David, and challenge you.
I wish you wouldn't, but go
I'm going to, no.
I just feel like I want to get...
I know, but you said this thing that all you guys talked about education.
Huh?
You said all of us just talked about education. And you didn't talk about crime. I would say that the problem we have on education, this is where we're not thinking short-term, we're all thinking long-term.
That's right.
Too long, our schools have become a pipeline to the criminal justice system because they weren't doing their job. And there's the reason you feel this sense of urgency is to make sure that there's not another generation lost with this education, because not one of us would be sitting here. And I include you if we didn't have, A, the love of our parents and a good education. And the problem is, for too often, the education system and our schools weren't doing the task they were set to give these kids the opportunities to do what they needed to do.
Can I invite a couple of questions here?
Hi. First off, thank you all so much for coming here. And I think one thing we all got, especially from this panel, is each of you has a really different style. And I bet that also goes out to how you've been governing as mayors of your cities. And I was wondering if maybe you could talk a little bit about how your personal style has either helped or hurt in getting your agendas done. Thank you.
You know, I'll take it up first, because when Kasim was speaking, I'm so glad you brought that up, because we could have had a discussion just about policy all day. And I think at the end of the day, who a mayor is how they're going to do. And so much of it comes down to that negotiation of saying, look, this is a math problem. Those workers, the leaders of those unions, had to trust this man. I had a similar experience with my workers. I was city council president at the time. But if they didn't sit down, if they say, we don't trust you, it doesn't matter what the numbers say. You won't get there. You know, we have very different styles, but I think we also represent kind of the scope of America. I mean, when I think about, we have to be culturally fluent, and I think that's something across personalities that we have, that we embody. I mean, I have an Italian last name. I'm half Mexican, half Jewish. It's like as if, you know, Bill and Rahm had a kid on a Mexican holiday. That's me. And we all have to.
We could actually, that would help us electorally.
Yeah, sure it would. It'd be a very romantic weekend.
That's
but,
right. I can't think of a nicer person to have a kid
but, with. But we have to rely on
What you say in Chicago, I'm sure it stays in Chicago. Yeah, I'll never make it to LA.
I like it. But we have to have those moments, and I think they're as different as we might seem on the cover.
Do you want to be adopted?
One of the things that links the four of us together is underneath that, I think we're driven in the same way.
The challenge part, and this gets me, and the promise. There's nothing more kind of symbolic. Last Tuesday, the city of Chicago was awarded this grant for the advanced manufacturing, $320 million grant. It's the cutting edge of both what I call brains and brawns coming together on the most important digital manufacturing for the country, and it will be the center, both for the United States, on digital manufacturing and all the research dollars that are coming in from the private sector, the universities, and the federal government. 1 week later, Moody's downgrades us because of the pension. 1 week, Tuesday to Tuesday. All the promise of this incredible opportunity. And I brought to the White House two kids from our STEM high school that were on the cover of Time magazine, Sarah Good on the south side, and Michelle Clark on the west side. Because that research grant, that opportunity, if they get trained, that's their future. The new companies, the patents, the license coming out. But if we don't deal respectfully in the right way on the pension, and Bill and I are now in the midst of that struggle, well, these two guys have a different set because of the hard work, people were yelling, that decision by Moody's can rob that future. You got it. And I said, like, we're going to get close to a time where you're going to pick between a pension payment, a pothole, and paving a road. And that's the wrong choices for a world-class city. And so that's both the promise and also the challenge that I think exists. And our states they got their challenges, and the federal government basically, and everybody talked about this day, there will be a day when the federal government is interest on the debt, national security, and entitlement, Social Security and Medicare. Well, folks, that day's here. They don't do after school. I'll give you one clear example. We did a 150% increase in summer jobs. 20,000 summer kids went to summer jobs last year, largest since the war on poverty. We were talking about this today. The federal government's participation, they had a 90% cut. It was 700 kids out of 20,000. I said, don't apply for it. It costs you more money to apply for it when you get the kid. We'll figure out the 700 on our own. They've left the kids because they're going to pay Social Security, Medicare, national security, and they're going to pay interest on the debt at a time in which your metropolitan centers are your economic engines and cut capacities. And so that's both the promise as well as the challenge of where we are.
Eric, you hear echoes of your own challenges in this discussion, or yours?
Absolutely. I've been enjoying listening to the three peers here that I have, my three friends, and it reminds me of Winston Churchill once said, everything that needs to be said has been said, but it hasn't been said by everybody, so thank you for asking. I agree completely, and I think there's something happening in this country, and in all seriousness, it's something that all of us really have to focus on as Americans. America will not come back and recover if America's cities do not. And in our state capitals and in our nation's capital, people have forgotten about cities. I don't want to say they've given up on them, because they've never been more exciting. They've never been a more interesting platform for innovation, for creativity, even city government, which, you know, when I look at Los Angeles and I said we had cutting-edge technology when I came in, but it was from 1982. You know, we have this moment where I came this morning from Mexico. The jefe de gobierno, which is what they call the mayor there, he and I got together. We're sister cities, as I believe Chicago is Mexico City. The first 2 minutes, we're pulling out each other's smartphones and sharing apps. He's got an app on air quality. I've got an app on real-time parking spaces in Hollywood. He has an app on where the protests are in Mexico City, because you need a whole app for that. And I have an app that, you know, like many folks do here, where you can repair a pothole in, you know, 24 hours by taking a picture and not waiting on hold. We have these exciting platforms. We have these renaissances that are going on. But what these three gentlemen were talking about is the same in Los Angeles with me. It is infrastructure and it's inequality or opportunity. Los Angeles is creating high-paying jobs at a faster rate than low-paying jobs, and yet our poverty rate is higher 5 years after the recession started than before. When I tried to square those statistics together and understand why, it meant that people who aren't growing up in my city are getting those jobs. So we're still magnets internationally, nationally, for people to come into the cities to get these great jobs as animators, as aerospace engineers. SpaceX, which is, you know, based in Los Angeles, is launching satellites into space. We have this amazing American innovation happening, but with no help from the nation. When we look at infrastructure, we have the biggest public transit infrastructure construction project going on in Los Angeles. Kind of the capital of cars is finally going to transit. But we had to pass a tax on ourselves, and we just come to Washington not with an empty hat in hand, but an almost full hat, begging for them just to top it off, and even that's tough. And when you face these cuts in the midst of the worst recession of our lives, to see block grants, to see home dollars for affordable housing, to see these things get cut, it's unconscionable. This is our tax dollars. For Republicans who say they want to give local control, give it. For Democrats who say they care about poverty, fight the fight. But you cannot give up on America's cities precisely at a moment when we represent people who are innovating, creating, and moving the American dream forward.
Amen. I think you hear in all of us a commonality that a self-sufficiency, sort of strategic dynamic that we have to make things happen, that we generate within our borders, because we understand the pressures that states are under, and we understand what we're not going to have from Washington. And everyone on this stage sees that as a challenge that we have to live up to, and we make things happen every day. But that doesn't mean this is a status quo that's acceptable for the long haul, because the future of this country lives and dies by the cities. We're the economic engines. And I think if you look around the world, I always like to say, look at your economic competitors. Look at how they think about infrastructure investment, how they think about research, how they think about investment in education. China, India, Germany, go down a list. All think of their government as the ultimate facilitators and sort of the pavers of the pathway, so all these other things can happen, including in the private sector, to lift everyone up. Here, we're stuck. then once again, where do we have to turn for a change dynamic? It has to start with all of us. And my theory has been that in sort of the Tea Party era, we can throw up our hands or we can say, wait a minute, the Tea Party was an organic movement that somehow ended up with outsized influence in the Congress and now is making everything else impossible, even though we command huge populations that require that kind of support from Washington, that kind of investment for the good of all. Those Tea Party congressmen come from states that also have big cities in them, and medium-sized cities and small cities, all of which need that federal help for infrastructure, et cetera, mass transit, et cetera. So we have to change the politics. We can't throw up our hands. We can't curse the darkness. We have to change the politics in Washington. I believe there's a way all of us working together can start to change that. We've seen some great things. My predecessor, I had some disagreements with him. There's some other things I thought very highly of, including some of his national efforts, for example, on gun control. But I think we all have to have a national effort on infrastructure. We have to have a national effort on Washington investment in the future of our country through our cities.
Yeah. Let me just return to for a second to the education issue, because you all agree that this is fundamental. Every single city is this is the tale of two cities to some degree. New York may be accentuated because of the fantastic wealth of the financial industry
and the cost of living.
But every one of you is dealing with this, and everyone agrees that education is the key. What are the barriers here? You talk about, what is it, NEET? Is that the no employment, education, and training? Is that the acronym that you use?
I mean, the barriers are will. We need to have the constraints removed from mayors and local governments to move as fast and to take an approach like Roosevelt. And you know it, David, from when you were leading in the
White House. When I wasn't alive when Roosevelt was
No, I wasn't.
I know you weren't born in 1968, but please.
No, I wasn't.
David introduced him to polling.
I was just focusing on the need for us to be much more urgent about the approaches to solving our educational challenges.
But what would that mean, Kasim? That's what I'm asking.
I'll tell you exactly what it means. It means going through the educational initiatives in your city, finding what works best, and using your political will to implement it faster.
That's right.
And what happens right now is, even when you have genuine success, you have to take too long to implement it. And we're not trying with the amount of urgency and importance that's related to the future of kids right now. So we have approaches that are not being tried in our public school systems because of the risk associated with the approaches. And the educational future.
The risk meaning what?
The political risk, David. So I had a question in one of the classes that I walked over here, and folks asked me about charter initiatives and school reform initiatives because I'm a Democrat. And what I said is, I will flat out support what works and what is verifiable, and I will put my political will behind it and take political risk based upon merit and success. And more mayors have to do that because we have the ability to move faster than they do at the federal level.
So Bill, you're in the middle of a discussion in New York on this issue of charter schools. I mean, would you associate yourself with what Kasim just said? And if so, how does that square with your view on the charters in New York?
I think charters are part of the lineup. I think they're part of an approach that we have to take that has to be transformative. I think the challenge, and we're seeing it right now in New York, the discussion often goes towards, you know, the education culture wars, as opposed to where are the vast majority of kids and what do we do to help them. So we're having some disagreements right now in the city on charters, but my central message is we're going to work with charter schools. We're going to hold them to equivalent standards that we hold the traditional public schools to. We're not going to create a favoritism for one group or another. We're going to work with all across the board. And we want all schools to be inclusive of English language learners, to be inclusive of special ed kids. We want a common standard. But that discussion pales in comparison to the question, for example, on early childhood education. And until recently, it was very hard to get a civic discussion going on early childhood education. There's no question qualitatively and impact-wise, getting early childhood education right, really making the focus on it, putting our money where our mouth is there, has a much greater multiplier effect than any other thing we can do in education. Extending the school day, And there's lots of ways to do it. We're doing it by the after-school route. But we know these are big structural things that in our city reaches ultimately hundreds of thousands of kids. We have a school system of 1.1 million kids, whereas charters in our city at this point are about 5 or 6% of our kids. So about, I think it's about 70,000 kids right now. So all I would say is that what a lot of us, I think, are affected by is a series of realities that don't actually, of political realities, of public debate realities, that don't conform to what is actually the most strategically necessary thing for the future of our cities. One thing I think you can find out about all of us, we are thinking about today, we're thinking about next year, we're thinking about 5 years ahead, 10 years ahead, 20 years ahead. Mm-hmm. For my city, I need full-day pre-K if I'm going to build the school system of tomorrow. I need after-school if I'm going to build it. I need teacher retention. You will not find a front-page story on the crisis of teacher retention in our city. I bet it's true in other cities, too. You'll find 100 stories on charter schools, but you won't find a story about the fact that we have a great generation of teachers. They come into our schools, and then we lose them in 5 years. And that's what's holding back public education.
Let me, 2 points, if I can, David. First of all, tenor-wise here, everybody will give you, like, on this subject, unlike any other, a sense of urgency. Every one of us. So if you pick nothing up, it's a sense on education, on that space itself. I'm talking about urgency in the sense of also what we started, but as a mayor, but the sense of urgency on education, because you see so much promise and so much wasted.
That's right.
Second, I think the entire debate around education has been screwed up by its politics.
Yes.
And here's what I mean. It's not about that reform or this specific, it's about quality. It's about quality education. And every effort, we did universal kindergarten, we're doing more on pre-K, Bill deserves a lot of credit for that introduction, we've added kids. But we have a view all the way through from early childhood, including the community colleges, so they're on the playing field helping kids get an education that lead to a career. But it's all about quality. Now when I ran specifically, you know this, we have a problem in the city which was the fact that we had 4 of the 5 top grade high schools in the state were here in the city of Chicago. And then everything else, people by fifth grade would flee for the suburbs because they didn't think they had a high school choice for their family. So I've reinvigorated the neighborhood schools with the 5 STEM high schools that go from 9th grade to 14th grade. They were just on the cover of Time magazine, so the Sarah Good. We've expanded now to the largest international baccalaureate program of any high school system in the country here, based on a University of Chicago study of IB versus selective enrollment. We've added seat to our selective enrollment in our best high schools. We now have more military high schools where there are 6 applicants for every seat. They have an 80% graduation rate, 90% college attendance.
Yeah. What a good-looking crowd. Thank you, Ava,
for that introduction, and thanks to all of you guys. I don't think there's ever been an assemblage like this on one stage. I was thinking when I was standing there, gee, I hope the boiler doesn't blow or something. We could cripple all of urban America right here. So my job tonight is to try and draw these shy, retiring leaders out in a discussion about their cities and cities generally. But I want to talk, I've got a great interest in the office of mayor. I've worked for a lot of mayors and I've been involved in a lot of campaigns. I think it's a unique office, but Ram, let me start with you. You were a congressman, you were the White House chief of staff. And yet you say this is the best job you've ever had. Why?
Well, you get to do panels like this, Dave. on a serious note, because you can actually not only come up with the policy, but you can move the needle and see the impact on people's lives. First of all, right now, not that it's been different, but it's kind of worse than ever. Washington's a bit of, you know, Disneyland on the Potomac, and it performs to that level. At our local level, this is the government that's closest to people and how they live their lives. Mm-hmm. Where you do a park, where you do a library, what you do. And you can move in a policy that impacts people's lives. Whether it's a full school day, full school year, we're redoing every playground in the city of Chicago, top to bottom. Mm-hmm. And that turns people out in a way, in a, at least those two things, in a positive sense of what they care. And I think you can not only develop the policy, you can see it through, and you can move the needle, and you can impact people's lives in a way that's actually relevant to how they feel they live their lives. And that's, and I'll give you, we used to be, as you know, David, because you lived here, we were a tale of two cities on recycling. Half our city had it, half did not. We made changes, and you go to parts of the city, now they thank you for recycling. And that is how they feel they live their lives, and that was a service we were delivering to some, but not others, and now we can do it. You couldn't do that as, now, I love being chief of staff. You know I love working for both presidents. I was honored to be congressman. But you can really move the needle and or put your thumb on the scale and tip it, and that in a dramatic way.
Eric, you were telling me a story when we were talking about this a minute ago. To talk a little bit about your experience. You were a member of the city council, and Bill, you were as well. What has surprised you about this job? Is it a better job than you thought? What is it about the mayor's office that you said every day is a good day for you?
It is, and let me say how wonderful it is to be here in Chicago. I'm not sure what all that white stuff outside is, and I actually put my hands in it and it hurts, but other than that, it looks really beautiful.
It's water.
Oh, it's water. That's what, thank you. That clears it all up. And we need some of that stuff, too. But we...
We'll sell it to you.
I guess I was
going to
say this later, but I'm so pleased to be here. I was looking at weather.com. It's 38, and I think it's a little rainy in Atlanta today. It's 27 in New York and 27 here in Chicago. It's 70 degrees and still sunny out in Los Angeles. So I invite you all to come to a beautiful city and see not only what real weather is about, but also to understand.
We can take showers year round.
Yes, that's right. That's kind of strange because it doesn't smell like that up here. But anyway. But we have a lot of fun, I think, as mayors. We connect instantly with each other because at the end of the day, it is accountable. It is immediate. It is tangible. It is something material. And I love this job. I mean, Rahm and I were just meeting earlier today, and there's really no downside to it. There's challenging days. There's immense things you have to overcome. Some of the toughest challenges in America really exist in cities. But the ability to live in a place and to have that level of accountability, if you don't fix it, you still live in that city, so you have to drive over that pothole. You have to see the lack of green space. You have to personally deal with those issues. But if you do change something, you get to experience that too as somebody who lives in the city, who's not commuting off to a state capital or to Washington, D.C. And the story that I was sharing a little earlier was I was with President Obama in the White House after I was elected, and he said, you know, how's the job? And I said, it's great. And I quoted to him President Clinton's old aphorism that the two best jobs in politics are President of the United States or mayor of a big city. And it was the week that the healthcare website was rolling out a couple other things. He said, you can scratch the first one from that list. So I truly believe we have the best job in politics. The toughest one, perhaps, but absolutely the best to see things like number of parks triple in the area where you are, to be able to see things move, to balance our budgets, the pension challenges that we've all not only attacked, but been able to go after in a way that we know 20 years from now, when nobody knows our names anymore, will make a huge difference. Looking at the way that really important issues like what Bill's doing in New York. I mean, this is of national importance to talk about universal pre-care for folks and the courage that mayors can have to put those things on the agenda when Washington is broken. I'll end with this. When I went with the 16 mayors that were elected last year with Bill to the White House and we had a meeting. These are mayors of great cities, Seattle, Pittsburgh, New York, LA, et cetera. And I said, if this was the 60s or the 70s and America's cities were burning, we would have been coming to Washington to ask you as the president to save America's cities, to have Washington save America's cities. But we're here now doing the opposite. America's cities are here to save Washington. And I truly believe that's what's happening.
Who wants to Who wants to sign on to the proposition that nobody will remember you in 20 years? You guys all up for that? So, Kasim, you were a state legislator for years before you became mayor. What was the perspective of a legislator becoming mayor and the difference between those levels of government?
It made me a better executive because I treat legislators well. And at the end of the day, if you want to take decisive action, you've got to get your votes. And so I served 4 years in the House in Georgia and 7 years in the Senate. And I remember the first time when I first got elected, I got up to speak. And the Speaker of the House, Tom Murphy, the longest serving speaker in the country, took the cigar out of his mouth. He said, "Come here." And I walked up, David, I had raised my hand. He said, "Son, it should be about a year before you talk." And I thought that I had been elected. And then he took my parking space and he moved it so far away.
It would be a year before you spoke.
But because of that walk.
That's right.
But it was great preparation, David, because it made me learn the rules. It made me train and be prepared and spend 4 to 7 years getting to know the state. And so now the city of Atlanta and the state of Georgia, which is very conservative, enjoys a working relationship that's rare in the United States of America. And I believe that it was because of those 11 years that I spent learning and gaining a respect for the state and for people all across the state, but also understanding how important the capital city of the state is.
And plus, that the now end you can talk day, whenever you want.
Yeah, I know. And then now, when I've got an idea, I get to execute. So I think that after being a legislator for 11 years, all of the things that you dreamed about, you get to go do. And when we're in the House or the Senate, we can keep running forever. But my job, I'm term limited. I got 8 years. And I say all of the time that cities are where hope meets the street. And when you get in those jobs, and you know you've got an 8-year time limit on you, it focuses you and causes you to make decisions in a decisive way and to take risk that you otherwise might not take. It changes you.
What about you, Bill? You like Eric's, were toiled in the city council for years. How's life changed for you? I know there's a lot of reporters here. I think that's one way in which life has changed for you.
There's a lot of reporters around. I've noticed that. First of all, I just want to say it's a joy to be with my colleagues. I'm the rookie of this group. It's just been about 2 months for me, but these are all friends. And we spend a lot of time over the months talking to each other, supporting each other, and that alone makes it a great experience. But I just want to say something about this man, because I have to embarrass him for a moment. I've known David for 14 years now. And you haven't heard it enough because you're too modest. You've done a hell of a lot for Chicago. You've done a hell of a lot for the United States of America.
Thank
so
you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I had two tough questions that I'm now going to eliminate.
Yeah, take those off. Take those off. That's the first lesson of politics. Be nice to the host. So I think the reality is, I want to pick up on what my colleague said. There is something electric about this type of work. And I've been a legislator. You know, we've all been legislators in different ways, locally, state, national. When you can have a vision, put it before the people, get it ratified by the people, and then, like a bat out of hell, go and act on it. And, you know, Kasim is aggressive, Eric's aggressive, Rahm's kind of laid back, but I'm aggressive.
We're all rated on a curve.
Everyone's got their own style, Rahm. It's okay.
That's right.
It's okay. Don't ever change. But the fact is, I actually take inspiration from Rahm's energy and the way you approach it. You put forward your agenda, and then that clock is running. Kasim said, you know, you have two terms. I look at that as a running clock in a healthy way, in a driving way, in an inspirational way to say, we've got to get a lot done. And I think if you look at the successful mayors, including the folks on this stage to my left, the success is in large measure by defining an agenda and relentlessly pursuing it. I appreciate what Eric said about full day pre-K, and we've said we're gonna get full day pre-K for every child in New York City, period. It's the goal, we have to do it. And it's gonna fundamentally change New York City and the future of New York City if every child is guaranteed full day pre-K. And then it's about marshaling the resources and building the support and having the fights and whatever it takes, but we get to do that. in a way we never could as legislators. I'm not, if anyone in the audience is planning on being a legislator, please do, it's a good thing too. I had a great experience. But there is something energizing, captivating about being a mayor and just the amount you get done in a single day. Sometimes I'm sure you've all had the experience, at the end of a day you look back and what you got done in a day that would have taken months in another setting, and that alone makes it inspirational.
So I'm gonna, Eric, I'm gonna give you less time than the others, and I want you guys to give me the brief, and I'll tell you why, the briefest answer, your elevator pitch for your cities. We have major cities from every region in this country. Well, you already started giving your elevator pitch. We're already on the basement. We've gone from the 70th floor to the basement. We've heard about the temperature, we've heard about,
the showers.
Yeah, well, we have, okay. Well, you'll get rebuttal time. No, but Kasim, let's start with you. When you talk up Atlanta and you're trying to bring businesses there, when you're trying to bring families there, when you're trying to bring all kinds of other economic activity there, what is it that you say about the city of Atlanta, the Atlanta metropolitan area? And I guess your microphone is...
Thank you. I'd say that we are a city that you can bring your dreams to. And we are driven by talent and merit. And that if you're somebody that values having a fair shot and a fair shake and wants to be at the heart of the city based upon your talent and merit, we're the place for you. And we're also a city for which inclusion is a part of our DNA. And we're the home of Dr. Martin Luther King, who played a fundamental role in expanding freedom and making sure that folks have rights across the United States and changing the tapestry of the country. And so what I tell folks is, we're open for you. And so if you want to bring your dreams to Atlanta, you're not going to have to wait in line. You're going to have a shot to be at the center of action based upon your talent and your merit, your hard work and your energy and your passion. And we're a city that's been built verifiably by dreamers and others who brought their dreams there.
So Bill, whatever happened to, if you can make it there, you can make it anywhere. Yeah, I got to wait in line
that's
in New York.
That's kind of catchy.
Yes.
Good.
Make your pitch for...
Look, I say with love for all my colleagues and the great cities of this country. I mean, we in New York, I can safely say we have it all. It is a city for everyone. It's a city for every kind of person.